so scheduling is simple. And with client notes and stored payments, you can offer seamless checkouts, so clients keep coming back. Run your beauty business with tools that bring everything together. Get started at square.com today.
I have to find a babysitter.
I have a lot of questions.
When can they start?
Today? Now?
How about Saturday?
Are they background checked?
My wife and I haven't been out in a year.
We need a date night.
No offense.
Find all the care you need at care.com.
Let's explore your future with Udemy. You can learn how to program and build websites, study design and create logos, improve your presentation skills and sell your ideas. With Udemy, you can learn practical skills from thousands of online courses taught by real-world experts. Explore your future. Udemy.
At Away, we know what real travel looks like. So when we make luggage, we think about how you actually get from place to place. How travel brings pit stops and welcome detours. How you deserve an easier, more flexible way to pack. Because when it comes to luggage, how you actually travel matters. Away, designed by travelers for travelers.
We just signed the lease on our third shop. I guess we're a chain now, right? We've worked so hard to get here. My assistant went to customink.com to get our new uniforms and merch with all the location names. Our custom gear helps him get our brand out into the community. He takes care of all of our custom ink orders. He was able to find great products, upload the new art, and have boxes sent directly to each of the shops. Custom Ink makes it so easy. Get started today at customink.com.
Hey. Rental?
Yep.
You?
Yeah.
You know your shoe's untied.
Oh!
Don't let a boxy suit ruin your night. Rent from theblacktux.com.
Like this one, it'll help them, like, do normal life. My dad's not just a hero, he's my hero.
Join our mission at hfotusa.org.
The Michael K. Show on Yes is brought to you by Untuck It. Shirts designed to be worn untucked. Shop now at untuckit.com.
And a good afternoon, everybody. This is indeed the Michael K. Show. We thank you for joining us on a Monday. It's April 1st. It's 2024. Michael, Don, Peter with you. Hope you all had a great weekend. Nobody had as good a weekend as the Yankees.
Nobody.
That's a pretty good weekend,
Don.
Pretty good weekend.
Pretty good. There was a few. I mean, the Rangers had, I thought, had a good weekend. But I'll tell you what. Rangers, Yankees, great weekend. Knicks, Mets, not so much.
Well, there's levels to bad weekends, too, though. I mean, you know, the Knicks lost a couple hard games.
Oh,
you know what I mean?
Oh, although, listen, of all the teams, there's one team that stands alone that not only got beat physically, but got mentally beaten and smacked around and treated like trash.
Flawed.
And garbage and loved it and enjoyed it and said, give me more. I want more. Thank you, sir. May I have another? That's the Mets. That's the phrase. It's not baseball hits different here. You'll see that on SNY. They will promote that as that's the phrase of 2024. Baseball hits different here. The phrase actually is, I'm telling you, it's thank you, sir, may I have another.
Now, you're not giving up on the season on one weekend.
No, I'm not giving up. It's Michael, they can't beat the Brewers on a bet. So if this had happened in the middle of August, nobody would blink. So it's the first three games of the season. That doesn't bother me. The Yankees aren't going 162-0, and the Mets aren't going 162. All right? This is a battle of first place teams tonight between the Yankees and the Diamondbacks. I'll bet my life that's not the World Series matchup. Very early in the season, okay? But what has been a recurring theme going back to the 100-win season is, thank you, sir, may I have another. Getting thrown at, treated like garbage, and always being on the losing end of the altercation. Hoskins owns the Mets. He's in their back pocket. He actually sits sideways. He's got a Costanza wallet in his back pocket, and it's the New York Mets because McNeil didn't punch him in the forehead at second base like he should have, like I told you he should have on Friday. Instead, it's Ramirez late in the game after he already beat you over the head with his baseball bat on Saturday. Instead of it being Severino with no warnings issued, Peter, before the game, plunk him at the beginning of the game, McNeil punch him. Instead, you get swept. Hoskins owns you.
No, it's not what you
want.
That's what bothers me.
There were no warnings issued when Ramirez threw at him either. So if they had the right, even if he throws at somebody without a warning, to throw him out. I guess the Mets didn't want to lose Severino at the beginning. So not only did they lose Ramirez, but then their manager gets suspended for the next game. And then today we hear more bad news. McGill had to leave the game after four innings. His shoulder was barking. He's on the IL. So now they're down two starters.
But, and again, this wouldn't even bother me that much if it was an isolated incident. All the times to get plunked and nothing done about it. And you heard what Hoskins said, that the whining and cry, that's the reputation the Mets have. Do you want that reputation? So why isn't things changing there? So if McNeil was so upset that he had to rage on top of the prone body of Hoskins, then punch him or don't say anything.
Right, you're standing there, and he's right there. If you're really upset at him, and I'm not advocating fighting, Don is, but no, I can see what he's saying, then you just jump him.
Make it a word.
Pete Rose, Bud Harrelson, do it.
And then Hoskins is garbage because he then decides to go.
Right, he gets
shout
tough
back
when there's people in front of him.
When there's people in front of him and he's in the dugout. All I know is that, Michael, if somebody's standing over me yelling at me, I'm going to get up and go, "What's going on? You got a problem?" But at the end of the day, he wins. His team wins. He did great. So that's what bothers me, is that stand up for yourself. That's all, and it's been going on for years.
So it's the New York Mets 2024. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
May I have another?
That's right.
Wow. I don't know if that's going to sell.
Well, you know what? It's the most accurate. Well, and listen, Peter's the one that knows what's cool. Baseball hits different here. I don't know. Is that cool, Peter?
All the companies kind of jumped to hits different, I'd say, like a year or two ago.
Right. It does feel like it's... It would have probably been better in 2022.
Yeah, it's just. And by the way, it was his hits different was about as fast a co-opting of a cool word or phrase as I've ever seen. But somehow SNY is still well behind it. I'm not exactly sure how.
Well, it's the Mets. It's not even SNY, but everybody's using it. It's their promo. The Mets are. I guess all teams are known for this, right, Michael? That they'll have some kind of catchphrase for the season. Like, when the Mets had the You Gotta Believe with the Tug McGraw. And they always have something that kind of, and that's this year's 2024, is literally it's baseball hits different here. But the way I feel.
Well, over the weekend,
they
didn't hit at all. So now let me get your take on another thing before we get into the positive news of Juan Soto. Mets lose the first two games.
Mm-hmm.
That night. Pete Alonso dancing on stage with Luke Bryan. Any problem with that at all?
Zero. Zero problem. I'm shocked that people have a problem with this. He's a human being.
Exactly.
He can't go out and have a problem.
I'm sorry. That's right. Sorry.
I mean, I have more of a problem. Like, I'm not a big, fan of that genre, but I'm not going to get on that. It's like, what is he supposed to, like, sit in a prone position, like in a fetal position in his apartment? Drinking beer out of a baby bottle? He had a home run on Saturday. I mean, Yeah, his team lost, but how do you think these guys get over it? They got their life to go
through.
Yeah,
but I mean, the flip side is you could certainly go to a concert, but then to be prancing around on stage.
Oh, my God. Did they lose the World Series?
No, I'm being...
Hey, When David Wells was on the back page of the paper partying after they lost to the Indians, I think it was, right?
Crushed.
In 97?
Got crushed by George.
And deservedly so. Your season just ended. Like, I get that. I can get you feeling crushed. Is a Major League Baseball player, Michael, that prepares himself for 162 games or beyond, is going to be that emotionally crushed and spent after a loss in Game 2, after an 0-2 start, a game he homered in. So that's it. I mean, how are you supposed to survive as a ball player? That means that you're, even if you win 100 games, that 62 times you've got to go home and have a good cry every time you lose.
I'm with Don.
I am too.
I mean, and by the way, and how, Alonso hit the home run. How else did he do over the weekend? Was he okay?
Okay.
He didn't dial up an Aaron. He didn't dial up an Aaron Judge over the weekend, did he?
No. Now,
but so even I if mean, he did, again, what do you want him to do?
Even if he did,
now you get eliminated from the playoffs. Yeah, that's a different story. I would think that would affect you. I don't feel like going out, but guy wants to have a good time.
Well, you know, I haven't.
But you know, enough about Michael. Time to talk about my team.
What does dial up an Aaron Judge mean?
Yeah, what are you saying, Peter?
What does that mean?
It was a rough weekend. It wasn't a good four game set.
Oh, really? You're going to concentrate on the guy who didn't do well rather than everybody on the team?
Well, don't be so sensitive.
Oh my God! First of all, Michael, how dare you? Second of all, you're not even a fan. You're a broadcaster. I'm a Yankee fan. That's my local team, Don. You remember? I decided.
And they're 4-0
under my as my team. They're 4-0. I'm just pointing out on my team. When I look up and down the lineup, I see one superstar batting over 500. I see another one batting under 150. We just got to talk through these things. That's all.
I've got breaking news.
Okay.
All right. I don't know if people realize it, but they're going to hear it here now for the first time.
Okay.
Juan Soto's good.
Oh, wow.
Thank you.
Who are you? Stephen A. Smith with hot takes like
this? I'm telling you, Juan Soto is good. And now everybody, you're a baseball fan. Of course you know Juan Soto is good. And I have long said that the Yankees make this deal even if they had to trade the players that they traded, even for 1 year. But when you get to see him pitch by pitch, at bat to at bat, he is really a special talent. I mean, that hit yesterday against Josh Hader. Not many people do that, Don. That's one of the best relief pitchers in baseball, left-handed, against Soto, game on the line, and he gets a base hit to left field. I mean, what a great weekend for the Yankees all around.
Don't talk to me. Talk to your fans.
Thank you.
The ones that call the K show. Oh, he's overrated. I don't care if they don't bring him back because they don't see, 600 home runs and 1,000 RBIs. And
Michael, we got a call during game one. We got a call saying Soto's not good. He's overrated. This doesn't make sense. He's just not good. So that
during
happened
game
during
one?
Game one.
During game
one. Yeah, during game. You mean,
did you hang
mean
up on the person?
Well, let's be fair. It was before he had a critical base knock and also won the game defensively. It was before that it happened.
But Peter, he got a hit his first at bat. So what made somebody think that he was not good?
It wasn't a home run. It was just a hit.
Just a base hit.
Well, the person who called, you are banned from this show forever.
But he's not the only one. There's been a few people that think that he's overrated. Here's the thing, Michael. I think I'm going to play pop psychologist. I think it's trying to prepare themselves for losing him in free agency.
Not falling in love.
So if I don't fall in love with him, I talk about how overrated he is. If he goes sign somewhere else, I can say, I told you I didn't want the guy anyway. So I think that's probably why they feel that way. And also, let's face it, Michael, I'm not going to get on Yankee fans because it's Met fans too. Baseball's a regional sport. So they focus on their team, and they probably don't really pay that much attention to what's going on outside of their team. So what this guy did in the National League with the Nationals and the Padres probably didn't resonate with a lot of Yankee fans. Same thing with, Met fans when they bring over a guy from the American League because they don't spend a lot of time watching those guys. So they look at the stats, and let's face it, the stat, they're not Aaron Judge stats. You know, he hasn't hit 60 home runs. He's not driving in 150 RBIs. But what he is what people have described him as, is like this generation's Ted Williams. I didn't see Ted Williams play, but I know he was pretty good.
Now,
and that's a pretty interesting comparison to me.
So the Yankees Evil Empire on Twitter, about 2 hours ago, they actually wrote this to me. You ready?
Yeah.
So when the trade happened, you were disappointed that King went to the Padres. How do you feel about the trade now, seeing the team first series of both teams? Don, did I ever say that they shouldn't have traded? I said The one thing that hurts is Michael King.
Yeah.
That's exactly what you said.
That's exactly what you said, is that you do it. You do it every day. 8 days a week, as the Beatles say.
Twice
but the one guy that you wish you didn't have to give up was King.
I'm losing faith in the human race.
What I need to do, I keep talking about I want Marco to be a lefty. No, I want Marco to be an ear doctor. Because I'm telling you, nobody listens anymore. Nobody hears anything. They must have bad ears. We must have a nation of deaf people. Because nobody hears a word you say.
Oh, I think it's deeper than that. I think people are morons.
Well, you come.
I appreciate what Michael said.
So think about that. We're in the first segment of the show. We're like 11 minutes in. He's already thrown idiot and moron out.
I support this. I sometimes need this. On our morning show today, we were talking about how dumb people were today. And sometimes I get frustrated because my dear friend, Shawnee, he's a great guy. But he's always sort of explaining what dumb people are thinking. Well, the thing is, and I'm like, sometimes I just don't have time.
Why is he the spokesman for dumb, Shawnee?
Yeah, why is he the spokesman
for
dumb?
No, I don't know. Honestly, it's a choice that he's made.
Bad choice.
He feels for the everyman and, like, wants to explain for them. And I think it's bad business to be in. You know what?
So he's dumb-splaining.
He dumb-splains. And I appreciate it. But, like, sometimes you got to just let people soak. If you have anything negative to say after this weekend. Now, Michael, listen. We were sitting here on the air. Your very own producer. Your crack producer.
Oh, it's really irritating.
The Marconi winning Anthony Pusick was not high on this Yankee team early in the day. Last week on opening day.
Wow.
He was not. Last Thursday.
Right. If he was a priest, he would be performing last rites down 4-0 in the sixth.
Wow.
Yeah, he was not in a good way. and listen, what I loved about that first game, Michael, and obviously this is our first time having the pleasure to talk with you since, what I love is you could totally look at that game through a negative lens. You know, leaving runners in scoring position, obviously seeing your starting pitcher on opening day just get knocked around early on. But then, you know, they ended up sticking with them. And lo and behold, things settled down. And even though they didn't do anything special offensively, they found a way to get a gutsy win. And, Michael, just as easily as you could look at that that day and be disappointed, I looked at it as, is this like a grittier Yankee team? And now you're sitting here at the end of the weekend at 4-0.
And against them, the team that owns you, they actually got breaks. Right, Michael? They actually caught some breaks. They situationally hit. Now they trailed in every game, and they didn't hit early, but they showed heart. Michael, I think Yankee teams in the past might have gotten swept in that four-game series. So to beat them, that's a big deal.
This is what this Yankee team's going to be about. As always, they put together a great bullpen again. Their bullpen, I think, 15 and third innings didn't allow an earned run. That's the reason they won. The Astro bullpen was awful, except for Hader. And then Hader ended up giving the big hit in the ninth inning. But for the most part, he pitched three games. Clay Holmes pitched three games out of four. The Yankees are going to grind at bats. So what they're going to do is they're going to take a lot of pitches. Anthony Volpe has already seen 70 pitches this year. He's had two swings and misses in 70 pitches. Now, he sat out yesterday because there's a stomach virus going around the team, especially the players that were in Mexico. But they're going to grind out at bats. They're going to get a starter's pitch count up. All the Astros starters pitch well. Then when the Yankees got in the bullpen, the Astros collapsed. They've got a much better lineup. I think that Judge not getting that many at-bats in spring training, well, it's manifested itself over the first four games. So he's kind of getting spring training at-bats now. But Soto's been unbelievable. Unbelievable. Volpe, unbelievable before not playing yesterday. Oswaldo Cabrera, John Birdie, the guy they traded for, which is a really good trade, made a game-saving catch on a diving stop on a hard ground ball down the third baseline, bottom of the ninth inning. They did all the little things. And one other thing I'm going to tell you that I noticed. I don't know if you guys did. Boone's a little different. Little different. Remember, Don, you remember, they don't believe in hot. Mm-hmm. They don't believe in hot. They don't believe in hot. They don't believe in hot. Analytic people don't believe in hot. Well, they made this trade for John Birdie. They made that trade because, essentially, in their mind, John Birdie was going to play third base until LeMahieu gets back. Then Oswaldo Cabrera has a big first game. Well, he was going to play in the first game, Birdie, because he got there at 2 in the morning. Second game, they run out Cabrera again. Another big game. After that game, Boone says, I'll probably play him the next day, which is Saturday. Plays Cabrera again. Then Sunday, The original lineup plays Cabrera again. Still no birdie. The only reason birdie got in the lineup is because Anthony Volpe was a late scratch because of the stomach ailment. So all of a sudden, kind of managing with his gut. Another thing the Yankees have never done. Use a reliever 3 out of 4 days. They try to stay away from that all the time. They went for it. They didn't throw some B lineup in because they won the first 3 games of the series yesterday. They ran with the same lineup that they played every single one of the first 3 games, and they used their closer 3rd game out of 4. I like what I'm seeing. I think they're going to let him manage a little bit. It's not always about, we don't believe in Hot, we don't believe in this, we don't believe in that. Let's roll the dice. You know what? They rolled the dice, and it worked out. I thought they had a really good weekend. Really good weekend.
Hey, let's not forget, Michael, they had an audit. And everybody looked at the audit as a way of how they were going to build their team. Is it possible that this audit showed that in games, maybe things can be done a little bit differently?
I don't even know if the audit's done yet, though.
But, well, in the process of doing the audit, could this be something that kind of came up?
Maybe.
Like, I don't know what I'm trying to remember what day it was that, because there was, you know, 4 games. But I remember I was in the car, so I guess it had to have been Thursday, that, like, John and Susan were, like, talking about what reliever did they actually go a second inning with that they never used to do.
Loaisiga?
Yeah, it must have been Loaisiga, right? No, it was Hamilton. And just where they were kind of discussing how that's something Boone wouldn't have done last year. Like, it seems to be a thing. Now, it's only 4 games. We'll see how it plays out. But I noticed that. I certainly noticed the lineup yesterday. I mean, how could you not? You've already won the series, right? That was the objective. And it's a day game after the last game of the series, and you don't have a day off. And yet he went out there and had the A-plus lineup out there.
And now they start a 3-game set against the Diamondbacks tonight. It's game time, brought to you by Tullamore Dew Irish Whiskey. Rangers host the Penguins at MSG tonight, with coverage immediately following us on 98.7. Yankees are out in Arizona, taking on the Diamondbacks at 9:40. That'll be on YES. The Mets welcome in the Tigers at 7:10. The Islanders visit Philly, take on the Flyers, with coverage starting at 6:30. That's on 10:50. And the Nets take on the Pacers in Indy at 7. That's game time, brought to you by Tullamore Dew Irish Whiskey, because when it's game time, it's Tully time. Tullamore Dew, the original triple distilled, triple blended, and triple cask matured Irish whiskey. Be sure to grab a Tullamore Dew. Try the brand new Tullamore Dew Honey during tonight's action. Glasses up to enjoying Tullamore Dew responsibly. Very quick explanation for everybody, guys.
Please, we're waiting.
So, did I miss every show last week?
That's right.
Every single one.
Don't worry, we held it down.
You did, and I listened to a lot of it. You guys are great.
Oh, thank you.
But
I do
want to explain to our listeners, because we're all a family. So when I went down to Tampa to do those 2 games, I did the game on Friday, did the show on Thursday, if you remember, then did the game and the show, feeling fine. And I went to bed Friday night, and like at 3 in the morning, I felt like my throat start to hurt, like I had a sore throat. And my nose got stuffed all of a sudden. I said, wow, out of nowhere, because I was feeling really good. Got up the next day, did the game, no problem whatsoever. Got back to the room, and then, yes, had its clients there, the advertisers, so I was going to go to that dinner that night. So I go back to the room. I kind of lay down in bed for an hour and a half, and I wake up. I couldn't speak. Out of the blue. Could not speak. Couldn't speak. And don't know what happened. So I went to the event, didn't say a word. Woke up on Sunday, still couldn't speak. Then I went to the famous Dr. Max April on Monday.
He just texted me that second. The second you said his name, he texted
me.
Just now, yeah. Isn't that crazy?
So he did the scope.
It's over there, huh?
Look at the vocal cords. He said everything looks good. It's not the same issue that you had when you had to have surgery. He said, but just to make sure, maybe I'm going to send all of this stuff to the surgeon, Dr. Zeitels. So he sent all the stuff, and Zeitels gets on the phone and goes, I have to examine him myself. So I had to drive to Boston the next day, Mass General, and he checked me out, and he said everything, you know, there was no damage to the vocal cords. They were just swollen, which is what happens with a respiratory illness or some kind of virus. He said, so you have to wait for the vocal cords to slow down. But he didn't see anything chronic, which was what I was worried about. And so he just said, you got to rest. He said, you got to stop doing what you're doing. So I didn't do the Met Yankee game on Monday, and I didn't do the shows the rest of the week. And I was hoping that I'd be okay for Thursday. They also gave me steroids. And they said, if you're still not right on Thursday, take the steroids 3 hours before the game, and that will lessen the swelling. Well, you know how my mind works, Don. I wanted to save this. I wanted them in my holster. So I said, yeah. I think I can do it. So I did it. And then I had Friday and Saturday off because of Apple TV and Fox, and came back and I did the game yesterday. And I'm still not 100%, but good enough to talk. And this is the first real test. We'll have to do a radio show and the game. So that's where I stand. That's what happened. And I still have the steroids in my pocket. I have not taken them. And that's where we are. So I thank Don and Peter for holding down the fort, and for all of our listeners for understanding as well.
Happy you're back, and hopeful that there's no setbacks this week and you keep on rolling.
That would be fun. That would be fun. Time now for the tournament update, Peter. Brought to you by Schweppes. Wow. The Final Four is set. Peter's thrilled because NC State knocked off Duke.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I hate to say it.
So their magical run continues against Purdue Saturday at 6:09, followed by UConn against Alabama. I don't know how anybody's beating UConn. And then we've got two unbelievable women's games tonight on ESPN. I mean, classic games, a rematch of the title game last year. So you have LSU against Iowa, Angel Crazy. Reese against Caitlin Clark.
You kidding me?
And then you have USC against UConn.
It's very good.
It is really good. And we're going to have a great guest, Andrea Carter, at 3:45 to talk about it, because they're expecting record numbers TV-wise, ratings-wise, tonight on ESPN. So it all starts at 7 o'clock. That's the tournament update presented by Schweppes. Schweppes offers above-the-rim refreshment and is proud to sponsor the Big East Conference. Enjoy the madness and take a break from the hoops action with a Schweppes seltzer or Schweppes ginger ale. There you have it. Are we ready for a great show, guys?
Yes.
And Jeff Passan's coming on at 4 o'clock. And he is red hot.
I don't blame him.
Did anyone post the text? I sent the text to Anthony. Did we post it?
I didn't see it posted. Post it.
That's not for me to post.
No, I said. I gave you permission.
I didn't feel comfortable doing that.
Yeah.
Well, what do you mean? I have permission from me and Jeff. He literally gave a thumbs up. I said, I'm posting this. He said, thumbs up. Don't you feel worried about it? Yes, he happened to use the S word in the text. But guess what? He's red hot. Now, I don't know what he... Don, he has nothing to be mad about.
No, it just... It's we had a theory on which way it could go with our listeners. And they chose one over the other.
Now, the one they chose...
They chose sex over weed.
Right. So, Peter's wife, Natalie, her drop wins over...
Oh, my God.
Beats Jeff Passan's...
Smoke weed every day.
And Jeff very upset.
Very upset. And by the way, accusing us of something nefarious, when in fact, and I'll tell this to him when we talk to him, Natalie didn't even tweet out, nor did I. No one tweeted out, this is close, go vote. It's how it went.
I think if we all were given truth serum, we wanted Jeff to win.
No, not me. I'm rooting for me.
Well, I wanted Jeff to win because...
You like smoke weed every day.
Well, no, because it's out of context. It's great theater, but for Jeff, we just parachuted in on something your wife said, and the pervs that listen to the show, they take care of themselves to it.
Oh, my God!
And I don't need that...
Get control of it.
I don't need that to be something that drives a vote.
Well, remember Gigi?
Yeah, you remember how popular Gigi was. Michael,
hi, and Robin.
She should have been popular because of how talented she was, and instead it was hi, Robin. And you know how these pervs go.
Wow, that's strong words. You've come out firing today. So,
well, the second I have a mistruth, please correct me.
Let's all towel off, and Peter will get us back on track and tell us about FanDuel.
You know what, Mike?
Home Chef's family menu is making it easier than ever to sit down and eat together. Our fresh pre-portioned ingredients and simple recipe steps are just a delivery away. Home Chef's family menu, solving family dinner one meal at a time. Get 18 free meals at homechef.com.
Growing up, I always wanted to do so many things.
I wanted to be a vet.
I wanted to be an actor.
When I was really little, I don't know why, but I wanted to be a pastor.
when I was like a small child.
I wanted to be a celebrity by any means necessary.
This is Spike Drop Vegas Heist.
These players are playing for a lot of money today.
I'm only here for 2 feet. I don't really care about any other place. Can't even comprehend what is going on, but I like it.
Today, I consider myself the luckiest man on the face of the earth.
Playing in Yankee Stadium is the best thing that could ever happen to a ball player.
This uniform on.
World champions, team of the decade.
There it goes!
The Yankees are back on top.
This is the Yankees being the Yankees.
Listen up, Nets World. Get into the action and lock in a 2024-25 Nets level membership. Members have it all, from exclusive events and behind-the-scenes access to discounts across merch and tickets. Not to mention the ticket flexibility in the first place with round-the-clock management and seamless transfer to your squad. This is Brooklyn, and it's yours. Become a member today.
New season, new reasons to say yes.
This is star power.
Wow. What a home run for Soto. Aaron Judge crushes one. Get all the Yankees action. The Yes app.
Right. Teaching is a journey that shapes lives. Are you ready? Explore teaching at teach.org.
You seek the key, but you must first learn the discipline. Lesson one, energy is nothing without control. Lesson two, there is power in silence. Lesson three, unlock the energy within.
When I hit 80, I needed help around the home. A friend of mine told me to call Freedom Care, and they'll pay my granddaughter to take care of me.
Funded by Medicaid, Freedom Care allows people to choose who provides their care, and the caregiver gets paid instantly after their shift.
Life is sweeter with her around.
Nana gave me so much joy as a child. Now it's my turn to return the love.
Call now to find out benefits and pay, and how fast you can get started.
For years, one company has battled to deliver business products the next day with no freight charges. Now, WB Mason, with their famous fleet of trucks and drivers, faces their biggest challenge, rescuing shipping and packaging buyers from expensive freight charges. That's right. Now, boxes, stretch film, and packaging tape are delivered the very next day at amazingly low prices. So, who do you call for fast delivery and no expensive freight charges? Who but WB Mason?
This is the GMC Sierra, powered by the TurboMax engine, with the confidence of 430 pound-feet of best-in-class standard torque. GMC Sierra, it's the truck. Current eligible GMC lessees can get this low-mileage lease on this 2024 Sierra Elevation for around $399 per month. We are professional-grade GMC.
Two things before we go to the phones. I told the story on the Yankee game. I have not told it on the radio. Different audience. So on the Saturday that I'm going to do the game in Tampa, as I said, I felt my throat get scratchy overnight. So I stopped at a 7-Eleven, which is right near the Yankee complex.
All right.
And it must have been about 8:50 in the morning. And I walk around looking for cough drops, and I don't see them. So I went to the young lady behind the counter, and I said, "Where do you keep your cough drops?" She said, "What do you mean?" I said, "Where are the cough drops?" She said, I don't understand. And she wasn't, like, English was her language. I said, "What do you mean you don't understand?" She said, I don't know what you're saying. I don't, what is a cough drop? I've never heard that phrase.
What?
And I go, "You never heard the phrase cough drop?"
No, this isn't real.
And I said,
"What you're saying right now.
Lozenger? Lozenge?" And she said,
That's even worse.
She said, "No." I said, "Something that you take when you have a sore throat?" She goes, "I really don't know what you're talking about." I walked out.
You walked out?
Yeah.
You didn't even just go look. I mean, Don, I don't know what's going
on. I looked around the store, and they didn't have cough drops, so I thought they were behind the counter or something. So once she said she didn't know what a cough drop was, I was out. I'm good.
Yeah, and so most likely they didn't have it, Peter.
Well, 7-Eleven, what they have is, at the counter, there should have at least been the small packs of Halls.
Right.
That they should have had Halls.
But she had never heard, Peter, of a cough drop.
It's very unfortunate what's happening in this nation.
Also, Don, I don't know if you know this, but I was told today, actually moments ago, that during the first segment, Peter with a little My Little Pony brush is brushing his beard on the air.
Did you see that?
On the air?
Yeah.
So he has a complete disregard for yes.
What do you
mean? Wake up, Flip.
You know, it's a thing to brush your beard. People brush their beards.
But not on the air.
People brush their teeth, but that doesn't mean it happens on the air.
You may be right that it's not the right thing to do. I'm going to push back against it being at teeth level, though. I'm going to push back. You got to give me a little room for beard over,
all right, well,
over teeth.
Like, if I was brushing my hair on the air, you wouldn't think that that was weird.
Well, I mean,
because that's the same thing.
Hold on, didn't the Fonz always brush his hair?
You're not the Fonz.
What? I'm just saying, though, is he loved or not?
But that was part of the act. You're in real life. Uh-huh. This is not a simulation. You're in real life.
Okay.
But when the Fonz did radio, he did not comb his hair.
Let's go to Billy in Hartford.
The Fonz?
What a place, Billy.
Hey guys, how you doing?
Good. How are you?
Good. She doesn't know anything about cough drops. That's weird.
Yeah. True story.
I'm glad you're back, Mike.
Me too.
I want to talk about Soto. If he wins the World Series, do you think the Yankees are going to spend a lot of money on him?
I don't think it's a bottomless pit, Billy. I don't think there's any guarantee. I love some of the things I'm seeing today on social media. People that I respect, too. Oh, you got to give him whatever he wants. Really? You got to give him whatever he wants. So if he wants $120 million a year, you're going to give him that? And that's why anybody after four games that's saying, well, obviously he loves the Yankees, so he's gonna go where they pay the most money. Now, he might have a good feeling about the Yankees if he's enjoying himself here, but he has Scott Boras as his agent. He's not playing. Pay him the money. Give him his bag now. First of all, Scott Boras doesn't negotiate during the season, so stop yourself. Second of all, give him whatever he wants. Really? Whatever he wants. I want $200 million a year. Yes, give it to him.
Well, remember, that's what they said about DJ LeMahieu. Not comparing the two players, but how did that work?
But, Don, can't you just enjoy what's going on now? Give him whatever he wants?
No, the answer is no. When again, I'm not talking about all Yankee fans, because I'm sure the majority of them are good fans. But the ones that call the show, that interact with this show, no, they can't have nice things. They can't enjoy things. It's always what's wrong with the team and thinking about the future and how it applies to October and during the offseason. Sit back, enjoy it. I can guarantee you one thing. You have them for the rest of this year. So enjoy it and see whatever happens, happens. And if you want to worry about what's going to happen in the offseason, why don't we wait till then? All right?
Let's go to Dan in New Jersey. Dan.
Hey, Michael, Don, and Peter, how are you guys?
Good, how are you?
I'm fantastic. The Rangers might be on the track to winning a Stanley Cup. I really think this could be a year. And then the Yankees looked great the other day, too, all throughout the weekend. Now, I'm interested to know, how much this is going this weekend will affect the expectations for this team. Because I know there's going to be a lot of Yankee fans that can be, oh, World Series, Juan Soto needs to stay here for life. Now, if Juan Soto leaves, they have Dominguez and they have Jones. Now, obviously, I'd love Juan Soto to stay because you could then potentially move Judge to first base. But that's a whole other story for a whole other in the offseason. But right now, I don't think any team from 2017 on really could have beaten the Astros in those four games like they did. I have one question. How did Girardi feel about being back there and watching his Yankees win against the Astros?
Well, he seemed fine to me, and that was the last place he ever managed the Yankees in 2017, yeah. The final game, Game 7. So that was a little weird. But please, I mean, again, we're such a prisoner of the now, right? The past Yankee teams couldn't have done this. Hey, well, here's a little secret. The Yankees were terrible last year. According to Brian Cashman, they were a disaster, right? They were 82 and 80. Do you know that they beat the Astros three straight in a series toward the end of the year? That team.
And one of the, and if I'm not mistaken, I think it was like in similar fashion, yeah. Right? Weren't they like all come
yes.
from behind victory?
Yes.
I think
so
they
everybody
were
has to take a deep
That's
breath.
A difference. I think they were at home. But, you know, also the Astros, I think, have lost, counting last year, like a ton of, like 11 of 12 at home or something.
I think it was 9 in a row at home.
It's early. But I do think there is something to beating them in their house. You know, Major League Baseball had it smart. These are two of the best teams in the American League. Let's get them together. A lot of attention. Two of those games were on national television. And I think it's something. All right? 4-0, that's no big deal. Teams have started better and didn't even make the playoffs. But I do think there's something to beating that team there four straight.
And I think the way they did it. I mean, if the bullpen is going to be stout, that's important. If they're going to grind out at bats, that's important. If Anthony Volpe has struck out too many times last year, swings and misses twice at 70 pitches, that's important. Juan Soto doesn't seem like he's stressed at all about being a Yankee. That's important. Those are important things that you look at, not more so than even the results. I thought Stroman was tremendous on Saturday. Tremendous. And I thought Rodon, he threw a lot of pitches, but I thought he did a good job on Friday. Those are the things you look for. You don't change your whole. I mean, if they were 2-2 this weekend, you wouldn't feel the same way. Look at the way they won. They came back. They battled. Their bullpen was great. That's what you look at. Give him whatever he wants. Give him whatever he wants. Whatever he wants. Whatever he wants, guys.
That's it.
Andrea Carter is going to break down the great doubleheader tonight on ESPN.
She's very good.
Oh, we'll see. You've been talking her up all day.
Yeah.
I think she's been. The second I first saw her on TV, I was like, she's very good. Who is this? Wow, she is.
She's very good.
She's a good player, but she's very good.
Very good. You're very good, too. Tell us some things.
You know,
Hi, Mel. Is now good for a quick catch-up on your plan?
Yes, now's great.
Refinance now or refinance later. Here are 10 tips to make your home
loan. Needless to say, your money could be working so much.
You know what? Yes, I'm thinking more long-term.
Interest rates will remain at current levels.
Great. We'll make that change to your plan and adjust as needed.
This helps a lot.
Bye, Mel.
Bye.
FanDuel Casino has your chance at the number one feeling, winning. Which ranks even higher than the 18th best feeling, saving a kid from a well. 59 years later. For the first time, new players get 200 bonus spins with your first deposit. Plus, get up to $1,000 back.
When I was 19 and I was going to shows, I was not thinking about permanent hearing loss. I wasn't thinking about tinnitus.
Sometimes my kids are having a conversation with me and that ringing starts in my ear. They're talking to me and I hear their voice, but I can't focus on what they're saying.
The audiologist, he told me that most of his clients are not old people. They're kids that have their earphones in.
I have a lot of regret about not protecting my ears sooner.
Protect your ears at all times, no matter what. It's not something you can get back.
New season, new reasons to say yes. Yes to the ultimate viewing experience.
Aaron Judge crushes one.
Yes to in-game live stats. And earn rewards and win prizes. Get all the Yankees action on the Yes app. Download now.
Hi, I'm Vanessa Williams, and I want to share with you the role that diabetes has had in my family. I lost my grandmother at the early age of 64 due to complications with diabetes. She was warm, generous, and a constant encouragement for me to follow my heart. Did you know that African Americans experience chronic kidney disease at a rate that's 25% higher than white Americans? And we're almost four times more likely to develop kidney failure. Diabetes and high blood pressure are leading causes of kidney disease, which can result in kidney failure, needing dialysis, or a kidney transplant. The good news is that you have the power to check out how well your kidneys are doing and learn ways to prevent them from failing. So go to your doctor and get yourself checked out. Visit linkbylovetv.org to learn more. Get the facts, get checked, and get healthy.
At Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, being the Northeast's best cancer center means being the best for you. Pairing the most advanced treatments with the most compassionate treatment. It takes looking at every cancer from every angle. And a care team that looks out for you and everyone you care for. It takes MSK.
The best ideas come from solving common problems. My problem? Like a lot of other men, I couldn't find a shirt that looked good untucked. So this became my passion, to design a shirt that captures the perfect balance between length and fit. Easy to say, not that easy to do. But with some innovative design changes, we did it. Our problem, my solution. Untuckit.com.
Is it possible to be more capable and more practical? Be able to perform here and here, make a statement while barely making a sound, and command the road as well as what lies ahead. How we get there matters. Get exceptional offers at your local Audi dealer.
Stay ahead of your moderate to severe eczema and show off clearer skin and less itch with Dupixent, the number one prescribed biologic by dermatologists and allergists that helps heal your skin from within. Serious allergic reactions can occur that can be severe. Tell your doctor about new or worsening eye problems, such as eye pain or vision changes, including blurred vision, joint aches and pain, or a parasitic infection. Don't change or stop asthma medicines without talking to your doctor. Ask your eczema specialist about Dupixent.
I was diagnosed at 65.
37. Earlier than most.
Every 9 minutes, someone is diagnosed with Parkinson's disease.
And every one of them can turn to the American Parkinson Disease Association. Visit apdaparkinson.org to learn more and show your support today.
Well, it might be one of the biggest nights in the history of women's college basketball. They're going to get numbers that have never been achieved before because these two games are just off the charts. Interesting, amazing, great rivalries, great players, stars, the whole deal. And, you know, it starts off with a rematch of the national championship game from last year. Iowa against LSU, Angel Reese against Caitlin Clark. And we want to bring in our very own Andrea Carter, who will be part of our coverage starting at 7 on ESPN. Andrea, it's Michael, Don, and Peter. How you doing?
Hello. I'm doing great. Are you kidding me? You just mentioned this being one of the biggest days, probably the biggest Elite Eight day we've ever seen. I get to be a very small part of it, and the players are ready. I just feel it. I'm excited. I can keep going, but I'll let you all go.
All right, so let me ask you this. Last year, LSU beat Iowa. What has changed that Iowa might be able to win this game?
Well, a lot has changed. You know, there were three players that combined for over 50 points in that game for LSU that are no longer a part of the team. Alexis Morris graduated. Jasmine Carson isn't there. And LaDeja Williams graduated. They all put up 20 points. Angel Reese got in foul trouble, and her teammates stepped up for her. But this is a completely new LSU team that at times has had to figure out how to put the pieces together in terms of their transfers. Angel Reese and Anissa Morrow now know how to play with each other, but it took some time to figure it out. And then at times, the team still feels like they're figuring out how Haley Van List can thrive. I actually think this is a game where Haley Van List could have a ton of success, but it's a completely different LSU team. Well, also, it's a pretty different Iowa team. I mean, Monica Sonato was a big-time piece as far as being Caitlin Clark's dynamic duo partner on the inside. She played really well last year. But these are different teams. The two superstars are the same, and that's why everyone is so excited. And it's actually been fun to watch some of the other players, Flaje Johnson for LSU, Hannah Stolke for Iowa. It's been fun to watch them grow and blossom this season. The eyes are on both teams, but you can't say it's exactly the same as last season because it's not close.
Andrea, you've obviously been at the highest levels of this game and know what these players are going through. Something does feel different, obviously, this year. You know, the Angel Caitlin story started a year ago. And I don't think for those of us who are at, you know, casuals, if you will, I don't think we had any idea what we were getting involved in. Did you know a year ago or maybe more than that, that we were really going to be entering this very special period for the women's college game?
It felt like that. I didn't know for sure, but with how big last season was, I just remember us all having conversations, you know, within the ESPN space, then the women's basketball space, even just the basketball space in general, like, how do we build off of this? How do we build off of this momentum? How do we make it bigger? How do we make it better? How do we support the athletes and follow their stories more closely to get back to this point in even bigger fashion? And not giving, you know, us all of the credit, because it's really been the players also. Like, their ability to handle what seems like this season more distractions than ever, from NIL to cameras on them to documentary series following them, to the new teammates and the pressure of having success and TV commercials and music videos, like the players being able to handle all this, that's what's been the most impressive to me. Because what would be the worst thing? We get all this buzz, they get all this attention, and then the basketball slips. Because at the end of the day, the stories are fun, but the basketball still has to back it up. Like, storylines might bring viewers in, but the basketball is going to make them stay. And so the best part that I wasn't sure how it was going to go is, what is the basketball going to look like with everything else going on? And the basketball has been great. So I didn't see it coming. I knew there was a possibility, but there's a lot that goes into growing off of such a big moment. And I do think because of the players and the visibility that we've had this season, we've been able to do that.
So how does it work for the athlete? Do you take all that into the game, the history of it, the eyeballs on it, the meaning of it all, or and use that on the court, or do you just try to strip it all away and just have it be about basketball when they tip off?
I think it, and I never made it to a Final Four. Shout out to everybody that's made it. It's not easy to do, but I do know for a player, and I've heard even talking to athletes at every level of this season, because I've covered every level of this season, from men's college to NBA to WNBA, and you might bring a lot on the court right before tip, right, or right before warm-ups, but when warm-ups start, you're right back in your routine, or right before tip-off, you're feeling it. And then as soon as you get that hit, you get hit for the first time, or you make a layup for the first time, or you get right into basketball action, you check a cutter, you dive on the floor, you do things that kind of push you right in the game. And, you know, I've heard some players say, like, they just try to hit somebody one time. Like, not an egregious hit, not an out-of-line hit, but just to feel the physicality of the game, and then they're in it. And now everything else goes away. Now it's me versus you, our game plan versus your game plan. I'm tired. I'm pushing through. I'm hurting. I missed that shot. I made that shot. You can become so deep. You can take a deep dive into the game once the game starts. And hopefully for these athletes, that's what it feels like. But I also have to think that when things start to go left or things start to go poorly, I think that's where it gets dangerous, because that's when it's easier for the thoughts of how big this is and who's watching and how many eyes are on this team. That's when those things creep in. So they have to be stronger than ever now when things start to go wrong to pull it back together. I think that's probably the hardest part from what some of the athletes have told me.
Now, I don't know if there's anything more that Caitlin Clark has to do. She's done it all. She's an inspiration for people. But our very own Jay Williams said, in order for her to be considered great, she has to win a championship. Does she need this win today to get to the Final Four again to continue to burnish her legacy, or is her legacy set?
Caitlin's legacy as the greatest scorer and probably the most impactful college basketball player that we've seen is set. Like, that legacy is golden. There's not anything that can be done, in my opinion, to change those things. She's already great. So that's, Jay Will, we're just not going to talk about that because a championship wouldn't make her great. She is already great, in my opinion, because her team is good enough to do it. Also because we've seen South Carolina play other teams close. It's not like South Carolina has just blown teams out of the water. Teams have played them close. So it is within reason that Caitlin Clark could lead this team to a national championship. They could have done it last year. They had a good shot last year. They have a good shot this year. I believe that a championship would make her resume goated. Like, there's, just think about this. I know players have won multiple championships. I know the players have won 4. I know players have won 3. I know players have won 2. But those players had WNBA lottery picks on their team. Multiple of them. At least one. A lot of them had multiple. And so, for me, winning multiple championships is a sign of an amazing program. But if you can lead one as a player, and I'm not saying Caitlin's teammates are bad, they're good enough to win it. So because it's within reach, because it's doable, because they're good enough, if Caitlin can lead the way, she's got to get one to be in the GOAT conversation. Her legacy is set as what it is, but it can go up a notch. It's not going to go down. Nothing's going to hurt it. Nothing's going to make it go down. But it could go up a notch if she leads this team to a championship.
And that's what's so funny because, you know, in sports, we can see a player like her be great and still lose the game. And maybe she's off and they still win the game. So it's so interesting how we attach everything to the star player. So I'll ask you, if she's great tonight, is there still an avenue for LSU to still win the game?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, there have been games, you know, we take it as the, I believe it was the West Virginia game where, you know, Caitlin, the team was 5 of 22 from beyond the arc. Caitlin was 5 of 14 from beyond the arc, right? So her teammates took 8 threes. None of them made one, right? Now you go up against, you know, the team Colorado that they just played, and Gabby Marshall's knocking them down. Kate Martin's knocking them down. Sydney Falter's perfect from the field. Hannah Stokey's running the floor. Like, when they're playing great, they can do it. But there is a lane, and we have had examples of Caitlin playing great and it's still not being enough. And so I think that is possible. It is not, and I think the thing to really pay attention to with Caitlin is not her scoring, but if she can get a double-double with points and assists, LSU's in dangerous territory. Because what does that mean? It means Caitlin's finding her teammates, and her teammates are knocking down shots. A good number just to think about, Iowa is 24-0 when Caitlin takes less than 25 field goal attempts. Meaning things actually go a little bit better when Caitlin doesn't have to do all of the heavy lifting scoring. So we could very well see Caitlin have to do the heavy lifting scoring and it still not be enough because maybe LSU has 2 players that combine for what Caitlin makes point-wise and then a couple other players step up. You see what I'm saying? So it's definitely not outside of question for Caitlin to play great and Iowa still fall short.
Now, one thing before we wrap, Andrea, so When did you start doing national women's college basketball for ESPN, for big ESPN?
Yeah, my first game, I called it a game. I think it was on ESPNU during the tournament. That was 2018. I called my first like tournament game, and before that, I did some stuff on SEC Network Plus and the SEC Network, but I called like 3 games that year, and then the next year I did maybe like 10 on TV. Next year I did maybe 14 TV games, and then ended up going full time. So it's been a bit of a journey, but I've been here.
Well, I'll tell you, in looking at your story, because for a lot of us, obviously, like I said, with the impact of women's college basketball right now, your visibility is obviously higher than ever. And your story is awesome, too, man. I just wanted to give you your flowers because, you know, seeing how your career ended at Tennessee and obviously you weren't able to go on to continue to play, seeing your story and you grind it out, congratulations to you, too, to getting to be sort of in the such a great position as the game is exploding. I love seeing stories like this from broadcasters, so kudos to you as well.
Oh, thank you. That was unexpected, but I really appreciate it. It's been the biggest gift I could ever have. Like a dream that didn't come true has turned into literally a dream come true. So I'm super thankful. I appreciate it.
Now, before we let you go, we can't forget the other game. This is one of the rare times that UConn kind of like is an underdog in a case because they had so many injuries and there was problems with Geno's health this year. What kind of chance did they have in the second game?
UConn definitely has a chance. I mean, the way that Paige Beckers and Aaliyah Edwards play off of each other, their pick and roll game. I have to give credit, speaking of giving credit where it's due, Ashlyn Shade has been lights out this tournament, knocking down threes. The Duke game was rough, but the Duke game, that was a rock fight for both sides. You know, that game was a struggle, but that game aside, the freshmen have been playing really well. Nico Mule's got to control pace and control the ball and take care of the ball. But if you think about it, the two storylines are Juju and her team and how her teammates play alongside her. Same thing on the other side. Paige and her team and how they play along her. I think UConn has less margin for error in terms of foul trouble, in terms of taking bad shots, those type of things. I think USC has a little more wiggle room in terms of not being sharp at all times. But to me, this is an even game that's going to be really fun to watch. Like neither team, I don't know what the spread is. I don't know. Honestly, don't even know who was picked to win it. But for me, it should be a fun, even game.
Good stuff. Thank you so much. Have a great time tonight. Be a lot of people watching.
Thank y'all so much. Enjoy the game.
All right. It all starts at 7 on ESPN. I think they're going to get 10 to 15 million viewers. I don't even know why ESPN, not that, you know, Bob Iger or Jimmy Pitaro needs me to program things. They should put this on ABC. I mean, what's on ABC that's going to be bigger than this?
Is it The Bachelor?
This would be bigger than The Bachelor.
That's the thing. It's you know, so it was on Saturday, Michael.
On ABC.
It was on,
yeah.
It was on ABC. And I was like, oh, wow. It's on. I looked on ESPN, and I'm like, oh, no, it's on ABC. And I agree with you. Like, if I would almost move stuff for this. I just feel like this is the matchup. And this is the game, Michael, that could outrate the final, depending on who ends up there. If Iowa loses tonight, this is going to be the biggest game of the tournament. So, yeah, you kind of want to move everything you can to make way for this.
Well, they're probably not going to move it, so tune to ESPN tonight. Starts at 7. Should be great. Hey, if you're like me, you love to spend time at home.
Flap it. Turn it over. There we go.
This grandfather's breakthrough, teaching his granddaughter the art of making pizza, was made possible by another breakthrough. The discovery of a drug that uses a patient's own immune system to successfully treat lung cancer. That's the pioneering research of Yale Cancer Center, delivered through Smilo Cancer Hospital. Together,
cheers.
We're powering breakthroughs with the greatest of care.
FanDuel Casino has your chance at the number one feeling, winning. Winning ranks higher than any other feeling, higher than number 30, saying, I told you so.
Told you so.
Higher than number 89, the feeling of catching your car keys with one hand. And number 78, thinking it's Friday when it's really Saturday. New players get 200 chances at winning with their first deposit on FanDuel Casino.
Welcome to Win Reality. Experience unlimited at-bats from home. See game speed pitches for more than 600 pitchers. Get ready for all game situations. Face your friends in live competitions. Win Reality. Baseball Uncaged.
There's always a fresh deal on the Subway app. How about BOGO 50% off footlongs like the irresistible Philly? What you gotta say, Clay?
There's nothing better than a...
Sorry, buddy. This deal is so big, we had to cut your screen time to fill it all in. Order now in the Subway app.
If you've been diagnosed with mesothelioma or asbestos lung cancer,
Choose the right law firm by asking, what are your highest verdicts? What experience do you have? How many lawyers are on staff? How many clients have you represented? Speak to Weitz & Luxembourg at 800-LAW-6789 to get unmatched answers. It's the biggest financial decision of your life. Call 800-LAW-6789 or visit misowin.com.
Everywhere but the seat. The seat is leather.
Alan, we get it. You love your bike. We do, too.
That's why we're America's number one motorcycle insurer.
But do you have to wedge it into everything?
What? I don't do that.
This reminds me of my bike.
The Wolf was about the size of my new motorcycle. Have you seen it, by the way?
Happy birthday, Grandma!
Really?
Look how the brush strokes follow the line of the gas tank.
Hey! Hey!
Brought my plus one. Jamie.
New season, new reasons to say yes.
This is star power.
Wow. Cole dials it up. What a home run for Soto. Aaron Judge crushes one. Get all the Yankees action. The Yes app. Download now.
Visit linkedbylovetv.org to learn more about kidney disease, transplantation, and prevention. Get the facts, get checked, and get healthy.
Oh, yeah. Yankees 4-0. Mets 0-3. Yankees tonight in Phoenix. Mets playing the Tigers. A lot of baseball to talk about. Time for Diamond Notes, brought to you by London Jewelers. And, you know, one of my favorite people is Jeff Passan. Boy, is he great covering the sport that I love for ESPN. But
he's a decent man.
Yeah,
too.
He is. And really, to see him hurt me. Because do we have the cuts, the drops? This is Jeff's drop from
smoke weed every day.
And this is the opposition of Jeff. Now, that's Peter's wife, and she won Drop Madness. And let's bring in Jeff right now. Jeff, as your friend, and I hope you consider me a friend, I wasn't working when this took place. So I want to apologize to you from the bottom of my heart. I think it was wrong what happened, and I think there were weird things going on.
Michael K., there's still some things that are sacred in this world. Like, I believe in 1-0 baseball games, and I believe in pastrami sandwiches from Katz's, and I believe in riding the subway to Yankee Stadium and Citi Field. And until last week, I believed in the Michael K. show.
Oh, boy.
And then voting for the Drop Madness round of 32 took place. And I happened to be seated fifth, and I thought I had a decent chance of advancing. Yeah. And what I didn't realize was that this was an inside job. It was completely rigged. It was the sort of nepotism that should embarrass everyone involved.
It embarrasses me.
If I lose to Bob Costas saying, get blunted with Rosses, that's cool. It could be Bob taking a leak or Terry taking a dump. That's fine, too. But Miss Hatton saying, oh, my God, that's what I'm out on?
I know.
Now, I believe the fine listeners and callers of the Michael K. Show know better, so I'm not going to blame this so-called vote on them. And despite, Michael, your pass it, sell by date, man crush on Steve Young. I don't think you're at fault here either, because you've got too much integrity to jeopardize the good name of your show on account of shameful actions. But you, Peter Rosenberg, you're the man who spends his leisure time around the double-crossing ways of the WWE. You're the person who sees The Rock and Roman Reigns saying that they would do anything for their family, including smashing a man's face into a bus. That's what you did to me, Peter. And if you can't respond, like, that's fine. I'll listen. But when you're done, and I have heard your lies and obfuscation and avoidance of a truth that is too ugly to acknowledge, you know what I'm going to say? Oh, my God. Because if you think that's a winning drop, you really do smoke weed every day.
Wow.
I'm gonna. Can I defend Peter?
I don't know what to say, how hurt I am by this. I don't even...
I just
go
think,
ahead, Don, please.
Yeah. I know the feeling, buddy.
What bothers me is our listeners, because this was a big drop back in the day, Jeff.
Hi, Robin.
There's a certain segment of our audience just hearing the female voice just sends them into a tizzy. Now, a lot of these people... Now, the reason I thought that you still had a chance...
So you're saying that your listeners are incels here?
Yeah,
that's right.
And what I'm saying is that I still thought you had a chance because those people also enjoy weed. But the face-off was clearly won by just the female voice, which in some of these people that were voting is a rarity. The weed's a lot more available than the woman.
Now listen, I'm gonna I'm not going to dignify I'm not gonna dignify the accusations because obviously they're ludicrous and we all know that. So I'll just get to the real issue here. You know, the fact is your drop is hilarious and that we all enjoyed it. When it happened on the show, it was a great moment. I of course appreciate it. Michael and Don obviously don't even quite know what it's from. But for me and for a lot of listeners, the drop means something. That being said, Don's right about one thing. A bunch of pervos listen to this show. And number two, you know, we talk about the usability of a drop quite a bit. As much as we love smoke weed every day, it doesn't get nearly the play that Oh My God does on a daily basis. And maybe that's a fact.
Why does Oh My God get a play on a daily basis? Maybe, I mean, if it was just some random lady from Yonkers saying it, would it get the play that it does?
What a good point.
Wow.
Don't know.
That's all right.
Don't know about that, buddy.
It's hard to argue that, Peter.
Miss Hatton has weighed in. She just sent me a text message. She has weighed in. Her direct quote, and I quote, is, "The people have chosen. Better luck next time, pal." That's a quote from Miss Hatton.
Of course, it's very easy for her to say when the election is rigged. You know, that's what
you
know.
You sound like a lot of you sound like a lot of politicians in this country right now. I'm not going to specify, but sometimes you just need to accept the results and move on, Jeff. You know what I mean?
No, here's the thing. I am accepting the results. I'm just simply pointing out that they are full of crap and that they are tainted because of the people involved and that the people should speak up about it because the power of this show is in the people. It's not in the ones residing in that chair. It's in the ones who choose to listen and keep you on the air.
You know what we should do, Jeff? We should get a group of people together and storm Peter's apartment. That's what we should do.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's where you're going to go?
Wow.
Well, you know what the crazier part is, Michael?
What's that?
Before you get to storming my apartment, I heard a phone call, a private phone call. It was Jeff talking to Anthony Pusick, and he's going, "I just need you to find me 200 votes. Find me 200 votes, and I win this thing."
Wow.
It was a perfect call. Okay, it was a perfect call.
Well, Jeff, I apologize. Again, I wasn't there. Maybe I could have changed things. Peter does do nefarious things. There's no arguing about that, so no, I apologize.
Am I going to see you at WrestleMania, Jeff? What's going on?
No, I'm going to be at SummerSlam, actually. SummerSlam's in Cleveland this year, and I'm from Cleveland, and me and a bunch of my... high school buddies are going to get together and bring in my younger son as well. So,
all right, deal. I'll settle.
Except for the part where I see you.
Oh, boy.
All right, so we got...
Cole is going to rant about the Mets to me, and Michael Cole's his both love and hatred of the Mets at the same time is my favorite thing.
I need you to do me a favor. We're talking about Michael Cole, the voice of WWE. He'll be calling Raw tonight. He'll be calling WrestleMania on Saturday and Sunday. I need you. I've asked him once before to come on, and he was busy. Don't you think that Cole calling this show to rant about the Mets would be insanely good radio?
It would be incredibly good radio, and, you know, a week ago I would have done it, but now I can't trust
him. Yeah, I don't blame him.
Position.
You know?
Don't forget. I always say that. Don't forget. All right, Jeff, let's move on to baseball. I remember a story you wrote, I think it was 2 years ago. That's the thing. I mean, I don't get to see Juan Soto that much, but you wrote a story where you laid it out that you can really compare him to Ted Williams over the first couple of years. Just watching this guy every pitch, Jeff, over the weekend, He's something different, man. And he's 25 years old. Is there anything that happened this weekend in Houston that made you think differently about the Yankees?
Yes. And here's the thing. I don't jump to conclusions after four games, and I'm not going to sit here and say that my concerns about the Yankees were wrong, because they are still a team that's on the older side. They are still a team that's gotten injured, you know, a fair bit through the years, and they are still a team, most of all, that doesn't have Gerrit Cole for the next 2 months and perhaps beyond that. That being said, the way that that offense produced, and particularly the at-bat that Juan Soto took, it completely transforms this team. And I thought he was going to have the same effect last year on the San Diego Padres, and even though he had a very Juan Soto-like season, the rest of the guys around him simply didn't produce. But seeing that lineup and how relentless it was this weekend against a bullpen that, remember, the Astros are spending a lot of money on every year. I mean, Josh Hader, $20 million. Rafael Montero, $10 million. Ryan Presley, $10 million. Like, this is a $50 or so million bullpen when you include everyone in it. And four times they came back on. I mean, they just made them look ineffectual. And, man, seeing that offense this weekend made me think, okay, you know, they are going to hit, and despite the concerns I may have about their pitching, and still do have, because I don't know that the bullpen is going to hold up the way it has, and Clay Holmes certainly was a little bit wobbly a couple of times, but despite those concerns, they may just hit their way out of it, and that's a hell of a thing to see, because the Yankees offense hasn't looked like this in a good long while.
Wanted to get my Met one in before you go, and I'm not worried about 0-3 because the Brewers seem to own them, and you know, you don't have DJ Martinez yet and all that, but
JD,
they got punked
JD,
again.
You keep saying JD. DJ.
I don't know why I do that.
Come on, man.
All right, you know what? I'm going to tap out. Jeff, have a good day.
Take it easy, John.
All right, man.
Don, go ahead.
He's not going to do it. He's going to lay out.
Oh, man, keep saying DJ.
Come on.
Like he's spinning, you know, vinyl.
Like he...
Well, because there is DJ LeMahieu in the same market.
That's fair.
Okay.
You know, that's
fair. Don, I'm sorry I said it. Please go on.
And Martinez hasn't been here. He hasn't even hit yet for the Mets, so give me a break.
All right, there you go.
All right?
Try again.
You can't even say the town that I'm from.
Hawthorne.
Great point.
All right? And you had the Mets go. You had the Yankees going after a different Bellinger the entire year.
Oh, boy.
Am I wrong?
That happened too. No, that happened too.
All right. So things happen, but when they happen to me, Jeff, well, anyway, we fight on. I think they got punked, and they've been getting punked for years now. Hoskins resides in their head. I'm of the belief that if you're Jeff O'Neill and you're going to get mad, punch him. Because there's only you can't get redemption in baseball anymore. All right? So if a guy's standing over you screaming, don't jog back to the dugout and then start acting like tough guy when you got all your buddies in front of you, but the Mets don't retaliate at all. He owns them on Saturday, and then after the game's already established big lead, then you throw at him. I mean, the Mets have been thrown at for years. There's been no retaliation. They're called crybabies by everybody. You're around Major League Baseball. Am I wrong to feel this way? Do they just look like a punkable team that you can push around? Because they are to me, and I root for them.
I don't think that they've got that reputation around baseball. But, you know, there's a fair number of people who think that Jeff McNeil is like that.
Okay.
And, you know, in this situation, I went back and I looked at that replay a bunch. And here's what I took away from that slide. It is a completely legal slide. Mm-hmm. And Rhys Hoskins lifting his foot at the end of the slide and it going into Jeff McNeil's ankle. Again, legal as part of the slide, but I don't blame McNeil for being pissed off, because anytime you get metal spikes dug at high speeds into your ankle area, it's going to freaking hurt. And if you look at Rhys Hoskins and the way he slides, you know, he doesn't slide early. He doesn't slide late, though. A late slide is an illegal slide. His slide is a good, hard baseball slide. And I think McNeil, in the moment, was angry, and understandably so, but you got to keep your composure there. You just have to, because you're right. Rhys Hoskins is in their head, fully in their head. And that's not the way you want to start off a season if you're the New York Mets, even if it is a transition season.
Dodgers look pretty good, but I'm wondering, is this all we're going to hear about the Ohtani stuff? Is this it, or are we going to find stuff out? And also, one other thing. I'm not blowing smoke. You're one of the most respected writers in the game. Why is
That's
it
right.
allowed for this guy to speak once? I mean, Aaron Judge speaks every day. Francisco Lindor speaks every day. This guy speaks once. Why is it allowed?
Yes, because the organizations hold Aaron Judge and Francisco Lindor accountable and say that it is a necessity for your job. The Los Angeles Angels never did that, and they established this practice where that's what is expected out of Shohei Ohtani now. And shame, because I think if we knew him a little bit better and if we understood who he was, then maybe we would have different feelings about him and all of the skepticism and cynicism about who actually placed those bets would not exist. Maybe he would get the benefit of the doubt more, but that's a choice that he's made. And it's one that I have to acknowledge and understand is the reality. Even if I disagree with it, I don't know what Shohei Ohtani's life is like. Michael, if you were to have 50 people trailing around every day looking for the tiniest little thing that you do because it warrants a story back in your home country where you're seen as a demigod and that arguably the most popular person in the entire nation, maybe you would be a little bit different, or maybe you would have a little bit different perspective. I understand in our little world of baseball, and that's what it is. In the grand scheme of things, it's a little world. Aaron Judge and Francisco Lindor are stars. They are the creme de la creme. But nobody is like Ohtani, where an entire country is hanging on every word you say, and every word you say is a potential landmine to be misinterpreted and taken out of context and all the other things that happen in the media by people who are less responsible. So I think more than anything for Ohtani, it's him trying to protect himself. But in trying to protect himself here, he's left himself more vulnerable. And it's an ironic outcome to a situation that I think is going to continue on for quite a while, because I do not see this investigation wrapping up anytime soon. And all I can hope, as somebody who is a fan of Shohei Ohtani as a baseball player and finds him to be maybe the most magnificent I've ever seen in my 21 years covering the game, I do hope the story that he's telling is true and that he's a victim and not part of something that they're trying to cover.
All right, two things, though. I was around with Matsui. Now, he wasn't as big in the States as Ohtani, but he was gigantic in Japan. He spoke every single day. Second thing I want to ask you, does MLB really want to find anything?
Do they want to? Of course not. Do I think that the league would potentially put itself in a position where there was some kind of a cover-up that, if it were exposed, and let me tell you, most things do eventually get exposed. The truth usually does come out. It would absolutely ruin the people who are in charge and the people who made that decision. I don't think they're that short-sighted, and I don't think they're that dumb. But I also don't put it past anyone to be short-sighted and dumb, which is why I will continue to be skeptical. I will continue to have that little twinge of cynicism, because that's what a good reporter should do. Like, the company line, buying it, trust but verify, right? I trust that you're telling me the truth. I hope that you're telling me the truth, but I'm damn sure going to go and verify it.
Like what's going on with Peter.
Our duty is as reporters. That's exactly right. In this situation, I trust my instinct, and my instinct tells me that something is rotten as hell.
Your instinct's right. Now, before,
yeah, I think so, too.
Before we let you go, Jeff Passan is our guest. Give me a number. Give me a number. What is Soto making per year at the end of this season?
$50 million
That's what I'm thinking.
Yeah. I mean, there are a couple different ways this can go. This could be an AAV play where the average annual value breaks the highest mark. Right now, if you look at Shohei Ohtani,
and you take that net present value as opposed to the value without deferrals, yes, he's going to get paid $70 million eventually for every year that he plays with the Dodgers. But the actual present value of that's about $46.8 million. There are other different calculations that are lower than that, but let's just use that. You could do that, or you could go for total value and look at, you know, 500 plus. But again, all of this depends, Michael, on how the next 158 games go more than they do how the first four games went. And to me, one of the biggest things that Soto has to do, no one will ever question his ability to hit. He is a generationally good hitter. But if he can shore up his defense and can play the way that he did over the first four games, the throw, the sliding catch, I mean, clutch plays, and sound defense in right field, nobody will have a thing to say about him other than, how much would you like me to write onto this blank check, sir?
Jeff, I'm sorry you have to go through what you went through this weekend. I truly apologize, and I feel
for
you.
By the way, Natalie has written again, and she started listening after the conversation started, and she said, now I'm sad I won this round. I really like him. So there you go, Jeff.
Well, what does that mean, Jeff? What is that? That doesn't help you.
All it means that she likes Jeff.
Yeah, that's fine. I appreciate it.
But it doesn't change anything.
Sure.
Sorry it doesn't fix the lamp.
But she didn't do anything wrong. She didn't make, you know, this is, Don, it's kind of like victim blaming. I mean, she didn't make these pervos vote for her. She didn't even tell anyone to
vote.
She
married you.
Well, that she deserves blame for.
Yep.
There's no question.
Thanks, Jeff.
Point. Later, yep. Buddy.
All this time, I just thought Natalie was an extremely talented photographer. And I come to find out that she's an election rigger, and it's
sad, right? It's sad. It really is. I'm sorry, Jeff. I really am.
I'll see you in Cleveland, buddy.
Look forward to it. See you guys.
That was Diamond Notes, brought to you by London Jewelers. Their wedding band event is April 4th through the 7th. Visit londonjewelers.com for more information. Now, we have more Drop Madness coming, but Peter, I'm going to risk something right now.
What?
So, after I jump Don for saying DJ Martinez, he says he's dropping out, right? And
right.
Then we get him to actually re-engage, which I was thrilled about.
Right.
And in the re-engagement, he said, what do you think about what Jeff O'Neill did? Jeff O'Neill.
No, he didn't, did he?
I did. I knew I said. I just let it go.
Do you have it, Anthony? Can we hear it?
Hoskins resides in their head. I'm of the belief that if you're Jeff O'Neill and you're going to get mad, punch him.
I mean, come on.
That's tough. He's the brother of Ed O'Neill, the fine.
And the cousin
McNeil,
of Paul.
McNeil. I'm talking extemporaneously. You make mistakes, too, and it's fun.
No, but I'm saying it's treated as fun. Like the Bellinger all year, right? Corey, Cody, couldn't figure it out.
Yeah.
And then we'd laugh, and then we'd let you move on. But we don't sit there and, like, play it back and everybody gang up on me that I'm the stupid one. You won, Michael. You got your name on the show. You're the big headed freak. You won.
See, I told you, Peter, I shouldn't have done it. But I
shouldn't have.
You shouldn't have.
Don, the former Maple Leaf Jeff O'Neill?
Mm. Well, the thing is, there's always a reason behind it.
That's right.
Because Jeff O'Neill's a talk show host in Toronto, and I go on with him all the time. We talk because he wanted, I usually help him with the football stuff off the season. We become friends. And you know, my head's in hockey all the time, so there's always a reason for it.
Right.
It's not like I can't do it, Peter.
No.
It's just that I'm talking about Jeff McNeil, but I've just engaged recently with Jeff O'Neill, the hockey player.
I get it, Don.
DJ, JD.
Yeah,
again, I'm used to DJ LeMahieu. Now Martinez is here, so you don't.
Yeah.
You see it, don't you?
Sure,
Michael,
I do.
Just assumes because of Rampo College and he's so much smarter than me that I'm a moron.
Right.
And he's hanging on the rim. I'm laying on the court. He just dunked on me, and now he's got to lift his leg, too. Like, he just can't stop. Just rubbing it in my face that he's smarter than me, that he's better than me, that he's richer than me. It really just makes me sick.
Oh, my God.
And I'm proud of it, and I'm going to refer to him to Jeff O'Neill now for the rest of the season. What does it matter anyway? You're going to go 0-162. But back to reality. He maybe said the Mets aren't crybabies, but sounds like McNeil's a crybaby. That's not a good look for him, right?
You know what I need to do, guys?
That's what's being talked about around Major League Baseball.
Can you please let Don go, Peter? Don't interrupt him.
No, do it. No, because he's got Drop Madness. There's more important things than, you know, where I stand.
I don't feel that way. All right, guys, let me start off with Drop Madness in the Flub region. Things are getting... This is intense now. This is very, very intense. What are we, Sweet 16 here, Anthony?
This will determine the Sweet 16.
Oh, this is the final from the round of 32. Okay, here we go. Flub region, 3 seed.
Glass half full.
Uh-oh, this is a big... Michael, you already think Don's in a mood?
Yeah, this is not
what
good.
What if the 6 seed wins?
Hit the post by the backhand. That one worked.
Yes.
Are you Jacob kidding? Doesn't work these days for some reason.
Yeah, Michael, this could all go bad if that goes to the Sweet 16.
Yeah, this is going to go so. But it is. Look, did you see? It's up. No, it's 73.5 to 26.5.
Oh boy, it's over early. Let's go to the funny region, the 3 seed.
See ya.
Up against the 11 seed.
I've got a team that stinks.
Now that could be a great matchup. That could really be a lot of fun. TNT 807 tip. Let's go to the troubling region, the 3 seed.
Your face against the freaking television screen, and you can't remember who didn't bunt.
Up against the 11 seed.
People suck.
I love this matchup. It really shows the crazed nature of both of my co-hosts on this program. Let's go to the nether region. Oh, boy, what a run it's been for the 3 seed. Michael, as a man who loves the language, don't you appreciate that he pronounces every letter in the word stinks?
Yep, all 5 of them.
It's really special. Yep. Up against the 11 seed.
What is your take on sausage?
Actually,
you can
6.
Go vote. You can go vote on your Twitter X vehicle, TMKS ESPN. Vote right now. Voting ends at 6:20.
Peter, don't you think that Don gets personal with me when I'm just trying to entertain? I'm being performative, and he really, you could see the things he really thinks.
But you're being performative at somebody's expense.
Well, that's what we do all day.
But it's the comedian poking at the fun at the fat guy in the first row. It's like, listen, I'm just doing what I do.
So you would have punched Don Rickles in the face.
But the point, no, but here's the thing. Don Rickles gets paid to make fun of people in the audience. So you're getting paid to just make fun of me?
I make fun of everybody. You make fun
of
me.
And you know what? The comedian doesn't have a relationship with the fat guy in the first row. But we have a relationship.
That's a drop. By the way, guys, it's all about, I think, feeling secure. And, hey, it's Peter Rosenberg, the security guy.
Growing up, I always wanted to do so many things.
I wanted to be a vet.
I wanted to be an actor.
When I was really little, I don't know why, but I wanted to be a pastor. When I was like a small child,
I wanted to be a celebrity, like by any means necessary.
This is Spike Drop Vegas Heist.
These players are playing for a lot of money today.
I'm only here for 2 feet. I don't really care about any other place.
My dad is a gamer.
My dad.
My brother.
My mom.
My grandmother.
My dad's a big gamer, still is. People will either like me or they will hate me. And I think that's fine. I'm okay with that.
I can't even comprehend what is going on, but I like it.
It's gonna feel like home. It's gonna be electric.
This is the Yankees flexing their muscles.
I think he's just gonna elevate everybody in that lineup.
He has the right demeanor to pitch in the Bronx.
When you play in New York, the expectation is to win a championship.
This is the Yankees being the Yankees.
Listen up, Nets World. Get into the action and lock in a 2024-25 Nets level membership. Members have it all, from exclusive events and behind-the-scenes access to discounts across merch and tickets. Not to mention the ticket flexibility in the first place with round-the-clock management and seamless transfer to your squad. This is Brooklyn, and it's yours. Become a member today.
New season, new reasons to say yes.
This is star power.
Wow.
Cole dials it up. What a home run for Soto. Aaron Judge crushes one.
Get all the Yankees action the Yes app.
We take hearing for granted. Hearing damage from loud sounds is permanent, but preventable. We take common sense steps for our health every day. Let's make hearing part of it. Wear earplugs. Turn it down. Give your ears a rest. Love your ears. Learn more at hearinghealthfoundation.org. Keep listening.
At SafeLight, we'll take care of fixing your windshield. But did you know we could take care of your insurance claim? That means less stress for you.
Thanks.
My pleasure. Have a good one.
You too.
Schedule today at SafeLight.com.
SafeLight Repair, SafeLight Replace.
For years, one company has battled to deliver business products the next day with no freight charges. Now, WB Mason, with their famous fleet of trucks and drivers, faces their biggest challenge, rescuing shipping and packaging buyers from expensive freight charges. That's right. Now, boxes, stretch film, and packaging tape are delivered the very next day at amazingly low prices. So, who do you call for fast delivery and no expensive freight charges? Who but WB Mason?
The best ideas come from solving common problems. My problem, like a lot of other men, I couldn't find a shirt that looked good untucked. So this became my passion, to design a shirt that captures the perfect balance between length and fit. Easy to say, not that easy to do. But with some innovative design changes, we did it. Our problem, my solution. Untuckit.com.
Is it possible to be more capable and more practical? Be able to perform here and here, make a statement while barely making a sound, and command the road as well as what lies ahead? How we get there matters. Get exceptional offers at your local Audi dealer.
New season, new reasons to say yes.
Wow.
Yes to the ultimate viewing experience.
Aaron Judge crushes one. What a win for the Yankees.
New season, new reasons to say yes. The Yes app. Download now.
The Community Food Bank of New Jersey is the state's largest anti-hunger organization. We provide nutrition. We provide support. We provide opportunity. We can't do it without you. Go to cfbnj.org to join us today.
LaGreca, Rosenberg, and Kay. With you until 6:30. Then we got a big Ranger game. Big Ranger game. Lots to do. Let's go to the phones.
Can we? Shall we? Will we?
We first will. We shall. Today, right? We can. Joe, West Palm Beach. Joey. JoJo.
Hey, Michael, Peter, Don. How's it going?
Great. How you doing?
Good, thanks. Huge fans. Been listening to you guys forever.
Joe,
you know, that's not how you start is, after super, all this.
This is unbelievable.
It's, think about it. After we finally go to a call, and that's what happens.
That's just awful. Anthony and
Come on,
Meltra.
Not WrestleMania week.
Anthony. What is going on? Anthony.
Oh, no. This could lead to something bad.
Player of the week was announced. Lourdes Gurriel Jr. of the Diamondbacks in the National League. He was 8 for 17, 3 homers and 10 ribbies. Juan Soto for the Yankees. 9 for 17, a home run, 4 ribbies.
Yeah!
Yeah. Let's go to Dave in East Hampton. Or Diane, I'm sorry.
Hi there.
Hello.
David's my brother. I know you didn't know that, but David was my brother. Anyhow, good to talk to you guys.
Thanks for calling.
And Michael, I just want you to know, Michael, I heard in your voice the first game that you did, the first Astro game. I said, he doesn't sound right. I was thinking that maybe you had a cold, so hoping that's not the case. Anyhow,
well, I think it started from a cold, Diane.
Okay. Well, I hope it just take care of
Thanks.
It, that's all.
I'm going to try
better. There you go.
Go get cough drops.
There you go.
So So I'm a Yankee fan who, or one of those people that, you know, you get to the point in the season where you know that they're going to have to play the Astros, and the first thing in your head is, oh, my God, the Astros are going to have home field advantage. That's not going to happen this year. We already know that that's not going to happen this year because they'll play the Astros only three more games, and that's in May, and no matter what, we're already ahead of the game.
But what if the Astros win more games?
I thought it's only if, according to who...
No. Like, if the Astros win 98 games and the Yankees win 93 and they meet each other, that doesn't matter about the tiebreaker. They both have to have the exact same amount of games before you got to a tiebreaker. So they both have to win, like, 92 games. So they have that in their back pocket right. If they're, in fact, tied.
Yeah, but it won't mean anything if, you know, the Astros have a better record.
Right.
No, but I just think it's good psychologically, because we were talking about it, Michael, before the season started. They own the Yankees. And I know they had that three-game winning streak, but in big spots, that's your new rival. I mean, there's Yankee fans of a certain age that hate the Astros way more than the Red Sox. And that was big. Yeah, it's the first four games of the season, but I thought who it was against was bigger than probably the record itself.
Let's go to Ken in Connecticut.
Hey, what's up, guys? So, first of all, Peter, I saw your tweet about your initial Yankee fandom and the undefeated aspect of it. I just want to say thank you, first of all. Just putting it out there. But also, I haven't been this, like, giddy since a series sweep. I don't know if you guys remember this. Like, the Boston Massacre of 2006, that five-game series in August where just, like, the Yankees ran through the Red Sox in Fenway.
Right.
That's the last time you were giddy about a series. That's a long time. That's 18 years ago. Yeah, that's 18 years ago.
And they've won a World Series since then.
Yeah. But the Yankees haiku is really what I called in about.
That's right.
All right. Here
we go. You chose us, Michael.
I hope you enjoy it. I was on hold for a bunch of shows, hung up, all that. Respect you guys. That's what it's about.
All right.
So here we go.
Here we go.
Clean sweep. Oh, so sweet. Houston, we gave you problems. Just one, baby. Next.
Well, that was good.
Wow.
That's his best one so far.
That was really nice.
Can I say something that's going to upset a lot of people? Not a fan of haiku. Never have been. Don't quite understand it.
Nor I, but I like what he's trying to do. And we won him over, Michael, because he was dropping that haiku on any show that would take it. And we told him he had to pick a show, and he picked us.
Now, Don, he said something about Peter. Peter had to get up and walk away because there was no reaction whatsoever.
Well, what did he say? I didn't hear. I was here. Yeah,
well, you see what I mean, Don?
Well, I'm here. What did he say? What did he say about me that I missed? He said
he thanked you for choosing the Yankees.
Yeah, and you didn't say a word back to him.
And you were taking credit for the going 4-0. And he said thank you, and it got nothing. He got eggs.
Oh, I did hear it. It didn't register with me.
You didn't hear it. You're lying.
What you're mean? Of course lying. I heard it.
You did not you hear it. If you had heard it, you would have responded.
What do you think I would have said?
Hey, thanks,
thank
man.
Me? I know I'm great. I know what I did, okay? I know what I've brought to the table. It's called 4-0. I don't have anything else left to do for this team.
God, well, you know what? He won't Except own it. I respect it.
I'm going to win another 158 and then talk to me. He should be thanking me. What can I say? And, by the way, Don and I have turned his bit into a thing. And I got to tell you, I don't like haiku either. And I don't like the fact that Don calls it haiku.
When did I do that?
You just did. You pronounce it haiku.
Well, I'm having fun with it. I can't even...
You got to leave Don alone. Everybody has to leave him alone.
No. You know what? You're right. I'm sorry, Don. I was kidding. It wasn't a big deal. Someone's going to catch it today, and I don't know who it's going to be.
It's inhumane.
It is.
It could be... Yeah. You never know. He is one Jeff O'Neill away from derailing.
Or a DJ Martinez. Let's go to Joseph in Queens.
Hey, how are you guys?
Good.
Long-time listener.
What's up?
First of all, if Peter's lying about hearing what the guy just said, he definitely rigged the election.
Of course he did. Of course he did.
How would I have rigged? There's no way I could have rigged the election.
You can buy followers.
And he knows how to do it, Joe. Joe, he knows how to do it, too.
That did happen in years past, so but I don't know how to do that.
Yeah, but you have all of your people from Hot 97. You probably told them, please vote for my wife.
You really think I did that?
Yeah, I do. I don't have high.
That is so sad that you think that. Why do I even bother?
Why do you? Well, Joseph, what else you have, babe?
I wanted to hit up Don. You know, he's getting all the hate today. Rangers hockey tonight, big game. I'm honestly a little concerned because last time when they played the Penguins at the end of the season, Tyler Mott went out with an injury. And we want to, you know, you want to win the division. You want to win the conference because you don't want to play Tampa.
That's it.
You don't want to either. You can't play all your star players. It's going to be a tough matchup. Always is. So.
But it's not. But here's the weird thing about hockey. I was thinking about this. Like in baseball, you would empty the benches, right, Michael? You'd play all of your backups. In football, you got a 53-man roster. You'd be able to play the backup quarterback. What are the Rangers going to do? They've got one extra forward, and they've got two extra defensemen. That's if Gustafson is okay, and he's not right now. So they only have one extra defenseman. So who are you resting? And playing Jonathan Quick, he's got 17 wins, so it's not like you're really taking that much of a step back. So I really don't know how you're resting anybody. Laviolette said he's going to treat every game singular. I want to win that game. He's not thinking about any other game but beating Pittsburgh. So theoretically, he wants to win out. And there is value to winning the President's Trophy because then you would get, an easier draw in the first round because Tampa is like the NHL version of the Miami Heat. No matter where they finish, it's going to be a tough out. You don't want that tough of an out in the first round of the playoffs. So I don't know how you can get around having to play everybody. Now, you might be able to reduce minutes and all that, but they're going to go with this roster. And they got a collective 14-1-1 record, Michael, against the teams they have left on their schedule. They've got a 3-point lead for the President's Trophy. It's right there for the taking. I wouldn't worry about jinxes. Try to get the best possible record and see if you can't get Washington, Detroit, the Islanders, one of those teams as the eighth seed and to play them in the first round rather than having to deal with the Tampa Bay Lightning.
Can we also congratulate Quickie, most wins by an American-born goalie? Can we do that?
Come on, man.
Hey, be Ryan Miller. It's really been an incredible story of incredible stories. Quick has been amazing. He would just wanted to kind of extend his career, play with the New York Rangers, the team that he grew up following. And he parlayed it, Michael, into a one-year contract extension. He's broken the record. He's one of the best backup goaltenders in the league. And I think the Rangers feel comfortable that if he had to play in a big game or two, that he'd find a way to win it. So it's really a cool story.
All right, Rangers tonight, right after our show, that's when the coverage begins. So tune in on 98.7. We'll come back. More of your phone calls. We'll still have to talk about the Knicks as well. Kay LaGreca Rosenberg and you on Yes and 98.7 ESPN.
The Michael Kay Show on Yes is brought to you in part by Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center.
At Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, being the Northeast's best cancer center means being the best for you. Pairing the most advanced treatments with the most compassionate treatment. It takes looking at every cancer from every angle. And a care team that looks out for you. And everyone you care for. It takes MSK.
Imagine yourself in a new Toyota.
Wow.
Yeah.
Woo! I love it. Woo!
Whoa.
Oh, hey.
What do we, Steve?
Winners.
I love you.
Right now, get 0% APR financing for a full 72 months on the all-electric bZ4X or lease bZ4X with $10,750 TFS lease subvention cash.
Ready, set, go get your Toyota today.
Toyota, let's go places.
It's going to feel like home. It's going to be electric.
This is the Yankees flexing their muscles.
I think he's just going to elevate everybody in that lineup.
He has the right demeanor to pitch in the Bronx.
When you play in New York, the expectation is to win a championship.
This is the Yankees being the Yankees.
New season, new reasons to say yes.
Wow.
Yes to the ultimate viewing experience.
Aaron Judge crushes one.
Yes to in-game live stats. and earn rewards and win prizes. Get all the Yankees action on the Yes app. Download now.
Pass the ketchup. Dad, are you okay?
Yeah, just stressed out.
Oh, and the melody is sounding so much better. I can play it for you. Wait, where's your guitar?
I gave it to your cousin.
What? That guitar's like your favorite thing.
I don't need it anymore. Some days are just better than others.
I think you should go talk to someone.
It's not that easy.
Have you been thinking about suicide? You can talk to me, Dad.
Technology is hurting our kids, so Gab created KidSafe Tech to protect kids from digital dangers. KidSafe Tech means no social media and more confidence. It means safe texting and peace of mind. Gab is KidSafe Tech.
Allergies? With Allegra, they won't stop me. Nothing beats Allegra. It's the fastest, non-drowsy 24-hour allergy relief. Live your greatness.
To get more hits out here, start training in here. Introducing Win Reality. Game speed pitches anywhere, anytime. Hands in sync with eyes. Confidence in sync with your progress. Be ready for real. Win Reality.
Hey, so I found a betting system that's really working great for me.
So did I. What's yours?
I set up an hour a week time limit on FanDuel. I can also set up wager limits, so I only bet what I can afford, and betting saves fun.
Right.
So what's your system?
What's that?
Your system. What's your system? What is that?
Every bettor has a system. Make FanDuel's responsible gaming tools a key part of yours.
We asked seniors how to prevent Medicare scams.
If you get a phone call, do not talk to the person.
Never, ever give out your Medicare number. Just hang up.
I check my Medicare statements monthly.
To report Medicare fraud, contact the Senior Medicare Patrol in your state.
Welcome back to the show. Don, Peter, Michael with you until 6:30. Taking phone calls right now, talking to you. Fran in Massapequa. Fran.
What's up, guys? Love the show. Loving you guys are all together.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's, I'm glad I started, you know, because I started listening, because I had told you I had issues down the dial. So I started listening to you guys in the beginning. I don't know why. I didn't like you guys. And then I just gave it another shot, and I said, you know what, just give him a shot. And I just, I caught on, man, and you guys do an excellent job. And I mean that from, a radio listener experience guy.
Thank you.
You guys really do a good job when you're all together.
Thank you.
I got a lot of sports issues. I do really good. Not really good, but I do good in real life. But my sports life is just horrible. So since the Mets season's over, and I know I'm 59, so I'm saying that facetiously a little and some truth. Since the season's over, and you know that, I mean, everybody's saying they ain't going to sign Pete. They don't want him back, and he's my favorite Met. And I promise that if they got rid of him, that's where I'm going, wherever he goes. Where do you guys think I'll be rooting next year? Do you know, have any idea?
Cubs.
Or can you give me an opinion of where you think?
It feels like the Cubs.
You think so?
But wait a minute, Fran. You like the Mets.
No, I love the Mets.
Okay, so you're going to not root for them if they let Pete go?
No, yeah, because you know what? Listen, there's just too much heartache. And I'm listen, and I know all that. Y'all, you're a terrible fan, and that's great. But I did put in, you know, 50 years of this misery. So you can call me whatever you want. I'm not leaving the Bears, who are horrible. I'm not leaving the Islanders, who are horrible. I'm not leaving the Knicks, who, thank God, turned it around. But now, of course,
let me stop you, Fran. What happens if they let Pete go and they sign Juan Soto? You're still going to give up on the Mets?
That doesn't mean a thing to me. I would like to talk about him next, if you can give me a second.
But let me just say, Fran, that if they don't re-sign him, it's not going to be because they're cheap. It's going to be because they believe they could do better. So why wouldn't you see that through to see if they can actually build a better team? Because
look, I'm going to say it again.
All right.
And I love you guys, and I don't want to start an argument with you guys about it. I'm going to say it nice. I'm a 59-year-old Mets fan.
Okay.
It has been brutal. My older brother, who passed away 20 years ago, don't ask me how. We have six sons, my parents. How is he a Yankee fan and all five of us underneath are Mets fans? So that, starting with that. So there's so much involved. I'm just sick of the Mets, and I'm looking for a way out. I know it sounds terrible. I'm going to stick with my other bad team. I'm so fed up with it.
But Fred, I'm sorry, man. It doesn't make sense. If they lose Pete Alonso and they sign Max Fried and Juan Soto, you're going to give up on the Mets? It doesn't make sense.
Now, you could disagree. I can understand the frustration, although you're never supposed to give up on your team. And if he's looking for an excuse to tap out, then tap out, man. Don't look for an excuse. Just go. But if they don't re-sign Alonso, you may disagree with it, but it's going to be a baseball move because they will have the money to re-sign him. I don't think I want to give that much money to him. And what if he wants $50 million a year, Michael, and the Cubs are willing to give it to him? As a Met fan, bye, because I think we could better spend that money someplace else, like on Juan Soto and possibly, than to give money to somebody just for the sake of giving it to him. If it's the Wilpons and they don't re-sign him because they can't afford him, they can understand the frustration. But it would be a baseball move. It might end up being the wrong baseball move. But wouldn't you want to see it through? Especially now that it wouldn't be all financial, that it would actually be about, I think we can build a better baseball team. Wouldn't you wait and see if they do?
Don, I think you hit it right on. He's looking for a reason to tap out. Because it doesn't make sense. Pete Alonso is a really good player. But if they let him go and bring in great players, why would you care? You root for the laundry.
Exactly. So, I mean, I'd hate to see Pete go, but if it makes them a better team by doing it, then by all means, please do it. Because as much as I love the players, I want to see my team win their first championship since 1986. So I think he's itching to go. Well, then don't look for an excuse. Just go.
And also to say the season's over because they lost three games in Milwaukee, that's ridiculous. I mean, I don't think the Mets are good enough to make the playoffs anyway, but these three games did not, change my mind.
Michael, the Milwaukee's on them for whatever reason. And if that had happened in the middle of August, you'd be disappointed. But, hey, what's the big deal? It's the first three games, so I understand it's a gut punch. But can we see how it plays out? You know, when the Martinez is going to come, that's obviously going to help the offense. I understand 0-3 looks ugly. You look on the other side of town, 4-0. But we could fast forward a month from now and things could be completely reversed, right? That's how baseball is. You're living and dying every single day, but in the end of the day, it's three games.
Let's go to Griffin in Connecticut. Griffin.
Oh, wow, here we go.
Michael, I love you. And I'm glad that you're back and you're fully healthy.
Okay.
And called the weekend, the Yankee game. During the weekend and during, but I don't like the way that you're attacking Peter today.
Peter,
I know that that's your plan. Peter? To attack
Peter. I'm going to attack Peter.
Go ahead, let him finish.
Oh, come on, yeah. Come on! You keep saying that he rigged the votes when he didn't rig the votes. Maybe Jeff ended up losing some Yankee fans' votes when he said they weren't going to make the playoffs. Maybe that was a possibility where some Yankee fans were mad at him, so they were not voting for him. Because you know how people use things like that, so that maybe could be a reason. Peter was hosting the show the whole entire time.
Thank you.
He was taking phone calls.
That's
he
right.
was having guests that were coming in.
Sure.
So he never was allowed to go on Twitter. And don't attack Don like you've never made any mistakes before.
Another
when you
great
wanted
point.
The Yankees to sign Clay Bellinger, it was Cody Bellinger. And because he made one mistake over DJ Martinez, when the guy is yet to even play for the Mets, So he would also maybe was thinking about DJ LeMahieu because of the injury that we got the update about.
Griffin,
DJ
Griffin, are you done? Are you done?
He's
now you're done. Yeah. Bye.
Oh my God! There's something going on.
He's
there.
Out. That might be a week for him out.
Wow. Well, wait, but because he had the temerity to stand up.
The
to
temerity.
You? The temerity.
Wow. You can't tell me, Don. You were with him. According to Griffin, Peter was hosting so much heavy lifting, he couldn't be on Twitter.
Well,
Peter could be going
through
heart surgery, and he'd be on Twitter.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sitting in front of a computer. I can still go on Twitter. But he's right about the fact. I mean, it does require a different kind of level of engagement, but I still tweeted
the only thing that you can accuse Peter of is that did he try to sway the vote on the air? And I don't even think he did that, Peter. You said you were rooting for Natalie to win, but it wasn't like you were really, like, guilting people into doing it or whatever. And you certainly aren't paying for votes. You don't care about it that much.
Why would I? It's ridiculous. The idea is absurd.
I hate to be the guy, but I believe that Griffin might have just talked himself off the show.
You know what? You don't like him. You just need to come forward.
You've got a little bit of an issue. You should be honest about that.
I like him. I don't have a problem with him.
No. You can't say that. Michael, you've left him on hold for 2.5 hours.
I'm trying to, you know, put him in at the right time.
Right, and sometimes the right time is never.
Right.
Because you don't care for him, and that's okay. You can't care for everybody.
I don't dislike him as a person.
No, nobody's saying that, but you're not a big fan of him as a caller. I think you need to own that. That's all right, Peter. Shouldn't he own it?
Absolutely. It's very clear he's not a fan.
You know what?
So now I've made enemies with Griffin, Danny from Long Island, JJ, who never has a good phone call from North Carolina. I'm really doing a good job.
I got to tell you, JJ, well, he wasn't very good the last time he called, right?
Friday, well, he's a 40% caller.
But he did very well up until Friday.
He's 4 good, 6 bad.
Real? Nah, you think Peter is it that was he was only bad the one time?
I don't know why Michael hates these people, but I would say he's like a 70%.
Now Danny is almost 100% caller, but he got on my bad side.
But any chance for redemption?
No, he could call in. I don't have to engage him. You guys are just as much a host of the show.
You're done with it.
Yeah, there are two other people on the show,
and two really good people too. Hey, I talk for a living. And whether I'm in the studio or at the ballpark, I'm sure to have a time.
The Michael K. Show on Yes is presented by Untuck It. Shirts designed to be worn untucked. Shop now at untuckit.com.
The best ideas come from solving common problems. My problem, like a lot of other men, I couldn't find a shirt that looked good untucked. So this became my passion, to design a shirt that captures the perfect balance between length and fit. Easy to say, not that easy to do. But with some innovative design changes, we did it. Our problem, my solution. Untuckit.com.
Is it possible to be more capable and more practical? Be able to perform here and here. Make a statement while barely making a sound. And command the road as well as what lies ahead. How we get there matters. Get exceptional offers at your local Audi dealer.
When I hit 80, I needed help around the home. A friend of mine told me to call Freedom Care, and they'll pay my granddaughter to take care of me.
Funded by Medicaid, Freedom Care allows people to choose who provides their care, and the caregiver gets paid instantly after their shift.
Life is sweeter with her around.
Nana gave me so much joy as a child. Now it's my turn to return the love.
Call now to find out benefits and pay, and how fast you can get started.
Here we are in Houston, opening up our first veteran village. This beautiful building that's going to house 161 homeless veterans. Any veteran that risked their lives and they're struggling with PTSD, mental illness, addiction. We're also building what I call comfort homes, 500 square foot homes. These are for older homeless veterans, so they have their own space and give them back some of their dignity, some of their independence, and most certainly give them back their life. Go to T2T.org to learn how you can change a veteran's life forever.
Gary, I got the new Extreme Multiplier ticket. What's this?
I couldn't scratch these tickets with just your hands, so I multiplied them.
Gary, this is extremely weird.
Is it, Beth? Or is it extremely awesome? Now I can scratch for 50 times the winnings, 100 times. I designed this little hand special.
Couldn't you scratch them one at a time?
Maybe.
More winnings could be in your hands with the Extreme Multiplier Series from the New York Lottery.
We all want to feel safe when traveling. That's why if you see something that feels suspicious, such as an abandoned bag or erratic behavior from a passenger, just call 911. You can call anonymously, and it's okay if it turns out to be nothing. Work together with the Port Authority of New York and New Jersey to keep our transportation facilities safe. Visit PANYNJ.gov to learn more.
Sorry, guys, that took me for... What is this?
Well, you know how our T-Mobile home internet can slow down?
Uh-huh.
Turns out, walls can get in the way. So, I fixed it.
So instead of getting a Spectrum internet, which is fast and reliable 24/7, you got us internet that can be blocked by walls.
Yes, but I think I fixed it.
By smashing a hole through our wall.
Well, technically, walls.
Yeah, I might not want to go in the dining room.
Don't settle for T-Mobile cell phone internet.
Kids are natural.
This is why I don't leave the house.
Get faster, more reliable internet speeds with Spectrum.
This spring is the perfect time to get away. With a great deal on your favorite Hyundai model. All backed by America's best warranty, plus 3 years or 36,000 miles of complimentary maintenance. Add more joy to your journey at the Hyundai Getaway Sales Event. Get in and get away now before these deals are gone. Lease a Hyundai Elantra for only $179 a month or get up to $1,000 bonus cash. Hurry, offers end soon.
When you have a new player play in New York, is how they are going to play and react to the spotlight. And if you look at the recent players that have come to New York, the one that I think has the most pressure right now, probably Juan Soto. He's established himself as an all-time great at the age of 25. But look at what he has on the line. He's going to be a free agent at the end of the year. I believe he's going to be the highest paid player in baseball history when it's all said and done. And he's playing for the New York Yankees, where the spotlight is the brightest. I know it's only four games. But he made that great throw on Thursday, hit the home run on Saturday. He had the big hit against Hader yesterday. The guy has really stepped up. He's just named the American League Player of the Week. I guess it's just a four-day week, but he's special. And, you know, I guess we should all be a little bit ashamed because we have such a New York-centric way of thinking that we don't see him every day, so we never really considered how great he is. So what we saw from him over the weekend is a guy that has changed the complexion of the Yankee lineup. Now, just Oswaldo Cabrera, who had seven hits over the weekend, he said all he does is watch Juan Soto prepare. Watches him in the batting cage. All Soto does in the batting cage is try to hit line drives and ground balls. Does not try to hit home runs, which a lot of people do. He has a way that he goes about his business. He looks like he's locked into every single pitch, every at bat. I think he enjoys the competition. And guys, I think what we're going to see, at least this year, is a guy who's made for this. He's made for this spotlight. I don't think there's ever been a player more apt to do his greatest things, and he's done some great things on the biggest stage, and that's Broadway. So whatever the Yankees traded for him, even if it's for 1 year, it gives him a chance to maybe win a championship in this 1 year. They've got questions. I mean, they've got to get Cole back, the whole deal. They've got to stay away from other injuries. Their starting pitching is somewhat questionable. Luis Gil goes tonight. But, boy, this guy has them take a giant step because it changes the thought process of how the hitters hit. They're just grinding at bats. They see how he does it. Before Aaron Judge even comes to the plate, he's seen 10 pitches in the first inning from the leadoff batter and then from Soto. Soto's first at bat as a Yankee was 8 pitches. That's what we're going to see all year. His on-base percentage is over 500. He had an unbelievable weekend in Houston. Don, this guy's a real deal, and he's gonna make a lot of money at the end of this year.
Yeah, I don't think there was ever any doubt, Michael. The kid came up, played in the World Series, what, at the age of 19?
Yep.
Now, it may not be New York, Washington, but it's a pretty, you know, decent-sized market. When you play in a World Series, that means you got tons of media around you, tons of pressure to perform, and he performed. And he knew when he signed Scott Boras as his client that he was going to try to get paid. So I never had any problems thinking that he was wouldn't be able to handle New York. Now, what comes first, the chicken or the egg? Like, do you struggle because it's New York, or does New York jump you when you start to struggle? Now, he's going to get a standing ovation on Friday, no matter what happens in Arizona, because of how he opened it up, and he's the big acquisition, so it's all good. But if he had gotten off to an awful start, I'm sure he would have gotten booed the same way Giancarlo Stanton did when he came back from Toronto when he had that first season with the Yankees. But we know Stanton can handle New York. It's just his body hasn't been able to, but psychologically he can. Will there be a time where he struggles, Michael, and he gets booed or he starts to hear it? And how will he handle it when that starts to happen? Inevitably, we'll see. But this kid has been through so much in such a young, compacted period of time. He doesn't strike me as somebody that's going to struggle because he can't handle New York.
Yeah, it was a pretty special lifting of the curtain. I mean, to start your career with the Yankees like that, because there is, you know, just inordinate pressure playing for the Yankees. And he just shook it off.
I mean, listen, and there are, you know, people like Michael Kay on this show who've said he's literally off to one of the greatest starts in the history of baseball. I mean, you're saying that based on statistics. And he, starting off
start
that
of
way
his
is
career, not just these four games, you mean?
Yeah, start of his entire career. Right. So to start off that way, when you come to the biggest market with the most eyeballs, it's been crazy. Now, I made the joke earlier, Michael, about Judge's rough start over four games. Was there anything you saw, though, that did concern you about the way Judge played? Obviously, it's just four games, but did you see anything, any tightness or anything in particular, or just a bad little stretch?
I just think that his timing's not perfect yet because he didn't get enough at-bats in spring training. You know, he was shut down for about a week, 10 days, when he had the MRI on the abdominal area. So I just think he's rounding into form in big league games. He hit some balls very hard. But, you know, he also bounced into double plays and struck out. But I think that Soto's only going to help him. Rizzo looked good. Stanton hit a home run. Cabrera looked amazing. Volpe looks like a different player. Good things. Again, there's a lot of question marks about the Yankees starting pitching. A lot. No way to get around that.
Right.
How big a difference do you think it made? Like, I know this is completely unquantifiable. But you just wonder, you know, if Rizzo doesn't get hit by that pitch and they don't make that ugly comeback happen on Thursday, I wonder how different the weekend is. And again, these are the things that are thrown out the window in baseball now, right? Because heart and feeling is completely removed from the game. But I really wonder, Michael, how much that gritty comeback set the tone for the whole weekend.
It could have, because comebacks beget other comebacks, because it makes you think, I can do it.
No.
And, you know, like every single game they won after the sixth inning. And that says something about a team. And it also sets into their mind, just keep doing what you're doing, keep grinding the bats,
yeah,
and we'll get to them. I think they have that kind of mindset.
Yeah, because, again, there's so much of the game that's mental. So the first four innings on Thursday, three of them ended in double plays.
Yep, with the bases loaded.
So you're probably thinking, here we go again. It's the Astros. We can't get a big hit. It looked eerily similar to like a lot of playoff games they played, not being able to get the big hit. And then they chip away, and they win the game. And that's got to mean something to you, right? I mean, I don't think there are many Yankee fans that felt great being down 4-0. And then you don't really do anything for the first six innings on Friday. So you're right. If they had lost that game 4-0 and it's 1-0 going into the seventh inning on Friday, you tell me that's going to creep into your head that you can't get a big hit and it just kind of snowballs. But now you believe after what happened on Thursday that you can come back no matter what. Now, I think that's a dangerous formula to think you're going to be able to do that every single game, spot the other team runs and figure you're going to come back and win. But it does show you there's a resiliency that you're going to need if you're going to navigate through 162 games in playoffs.
Peter, if you need another reason to be all in on the Yankee bandwagon this year, So the Yankees signed Jake Cousins after trading for him to a major league contract, called him up today. They designated the lefty Tanner Tully for assignment. Jake Cousins is the cousin.
No.
Yeah, of Kirk Cousins.
Oh, boy. This team keeps getting better.
Am I right?
Wow.
Wow.
I knew you'd like that.
About that.
I do.
Take some phone calls.
Take that.
Anthony in the mail truck is going to give it another try. Anthony.
Oh, we're here, Michael. How are we doing?
Get off the speaker.
There we go.
Can you hear me now?
No.
I guess.
Still speaking.
How are we doing?
Now,
there
good.
There you go.
We're doing better now. Sorry, fellas. So, Michael, I think you talked with the Yankees so far.
Anthony, you got to try it again. You sound like you're talking in the hallway. We need quality phones.
What's happening today? I don't like it. So much is happening. Maybe this is the way it has to be, though. Don, maybe if the Yankees stink, the phone calls are perfectly clear and we can hear everyone complaining. But when the Yankees are playing gloriously, our phone calls will just be off.
Let's go to E in Queens. E.
Hey. E.
What's going on, guys?
What's going on?
Happy Monday. A couple of things. First of all, tough day for Griffin. Fran, what a gutless call. Have some conviction, be a man, and just bow out of being a Mets fan on your own. You don't have to wait for them not to sign Pete Alonso.
You know what? That might be point God.
Yeah, because you know what it is, and I'll let you finish your point. It's... They want to have the origin story on why they're no longer a Met fan, right? So they want it to be good, like, oh, I was all in, and then they didn't re-sign Pete Alonso, and I was done. Kind of like Carlin. Oh, he wanted to find a way to get out, so he waited for like Mookie Wilson to get traded to the Blue Jays. That's his origin story. And you fast forward 30 years later, and we're buying into it when he actually is just a fraud. And it's the same thing with Fran. He wants a great origin story so we don't call him a fraud. I'm calling him a fraud right out of the box. Tap out. Own it.
A gutless fraud. two things. One story, guys. I called into the Michael Kay Show when I was like 10 years old. And I was so nervous that when the guy asked me my age, because I guess I sounded like a child, I hung up right away. So all these years later, he'd still be calling in.
I wonder who the call screener was then. It could have been Dan Grasso.
I think it was like 2005,
ooh.
I want to say.
So you were 10 in 2005. So you're about 30 now.
I'm almost. I just turned 29 last week.
Beautiful,
wow, Michael. Yeah. Think of that. Doesn't that humble you, Michael?
It really does.
my last point. I feel like I've had some contribution to this show. Mm. First, being the last Mets fan to call Michael a Yankee boy before he fully leaned into it and then started making merch, and now making Peter plant his flag and become a Yankee fan. Yankee fans should be on their knees thanking me with this 4-0 start.
Look what you've done. Look what you've done.
So you think it's all
Look
Peter?
What I've done. Just
he doesn't. Who knows?
It
we don't
be.
Know.
It might be. There's no way to say that it's not.
Well,
thanks, guys.
Well, you keep hanging on that Remy. You know we helped raise you, Don.
God, he was 10, and now he's a 29-year-old man. And that's not even when the show started. The show started 3 years before that.
We've done a good job raising these people.
God, and there's so many, like, you know, Gross has moved on to bigger, better things than being a call screener for us. If it was Tom Krasnicki, he's doing afternoon drive in Tampa. Leaving the show is the best thing that could happen to the person that leaves the show, right? Michelle Beadle, Ruco.
Well, we're still, you know, Andrew's waiting for, you know, the lotto.
Well, nothing. There's no absolutes, Michael. And I'm sure he's going to eventually do well. There's no timetable for this. Right, John Rothstein? Bigger and better things.
Sure.
Winthrop said that could have been him because he used to question the age of callers.
Oh, really?
Yep. Pinhead suit, Winthrop.
Think about that. He went from call screener to PD. How about that?
Amazing. We make careers. We make people. We raise people.
You know what? How about this? I was today years old when I found out that Dan Grasso was a call screener on this show.
Yeah. He started out as an intern working for Steve Hart and Promotions. And then he graduated to the call screening on this show.
That's when Don and he started to hold hands during commercials.
That's when we became friends, Peter. There was... no physical contact the way he's trying to make it out to be. That's when, you know, because people meet and become friends. That is just such, that's so rare for
it's
Michael.
Foreign it's foreign for me.
It's such a foreign subject that two people could work together, discover they have similar interests, and become friends.
Yeah.
Everything's got to be weird and ugly and awkward. I don't understand why he thinks me becoming friends with Dan is so strange. What, I was a host that became friends with a call screener? What, I lowered myself, Michael?
Yes, that's what he
is
means.
Is that what it is?
No.
That is what it is.
Not at all. Jonathan in L.A.
Hi, guys.
Hi, guys.
Hi, Jonathan.
How's it going, fellas? I was really fortunate to go to opening day with my six-year-old son. And guess what, Michael? As soon as we got there, I think there were pretty good seats. It was right behind the Yankees dugout. As soon as we got there, he asked me, since he's used to me listening to you, Papi, well, where's Michael K? Oh, we look up, and we see a beautiful yellow tie. I'm like, that's Michael K right there.
Why don't you say hello?
But, well, we tried getting through the seats, but they ain't let us. Oh. We're not that rich, Michael.
Yeah, it's hard.
But I'm really fortunate to. We're actually going to go to Wednesday's game, and we're going to try to go to your suite and try to say hello. But I wanted to ask a question to Pete and Don. Guys, I don't think Michael really paid that Pusick bet off. He just had it on for one day. So since we're going to the game, we're going to be right behind home plate. What do you guys think? It's up to you guys. I'll do a cardboard face of Michael with the Pusick behind home plate. It's up to you guys.
No, I'm not going to stop you if you want to do it. You, Peter?
Peter?
No. I support you.
How are you going to do this? You're going to go like Kinko's and get it made? You have a picture?
Yes, I have a picture on the ESP, I think the Team KS has a picture of Michael with the Pusick.
So you're going to make a Michael K, in essence, you're going to make a Michael K fathead with the Pusick, and you're going to sit behind home plate.
I love it. I love it.
I was actually going to call in last week to go to opening day, but I was like, you know, I'm just going to try this week since I'm going to Arizona. Thank God I got through the line, and, you know, here I am.
Well, do it. I dare you. I dare you to do it. I dare you.
He's daring you.
Dare you to do it.
And you know what? I know Michael for a long time. He doesn't think he can.
No, I don't think you will. And if you do, obviously we use the center field camera a lot. It will be on yes. But you know what, Jonathan? I defy you to do it. I don't think you'll do it. I don't think you have the sack to do it.
No.
Oh, my gosh. He's calling you a gutless puke.
Yep.
Yeah.
Not going to happen.
I have to do it now.
He won't do it. He still won't do it.
So he's quite the globetrotter, right? He was in Houston for opening
day.
Yeah,
he doesn't have money for good seats. He's flying to Houston. He's flying from L.A. to Arizona.
Hold on. Emphasis is he said we're not that rich. So he's obviously doing just fine. He's moving around here. Yeah. He's like the Ira of the Yankees. I mean,
but you know what, Peter? He still won't do it.
I don't know why you're challenging this way.
Because I could tell when people don't have it. He doesn't have it.
You think he's all talk?
Yeah, he's not going to do it.
Don, you were just taking a big old drink, weren't you?
Yeah, but it wasn't like your ice situation. Don't try to spin it that I was being disrespectful.
I got to tell you one thing.
I'm allowed to hydrate.
I heard him swigging around.
I have really
swigging.
Grown up.
What's that?
Because Don said something that I could have jumped him on at the end of the 4 o'clock hour, and I didn't because I'm
what
grown
was
up.
It
no, I'm not going to do
tell
it.
Tell me. No, I want to know.
I'm not going to do it.
It's okay to call me out. Just don't mock me.
No, because that's what the show's about. But you've derailed
it, Peter?
The show.
Do you remember?
No.
It's about Scott Boras.
What did I say?
You know it, right?
He hired Scott Boras as his agent. Did I mispronounce Boras?
He said that Soto signed Scott Boras as his client.
Oh, boy.
See, that's nitpicking. Peter, that's nitpicking. We're talking extemporaneously. Things sometimes come out sideways. That just happened. If we're just going to play that game. But you know what? I can't jump you because you didn't do it. I asked you, and you gave it to me, but that doesn't even bother me. That's just talking.
I like it. I like this approach. Hey, Don, I finished Breakdown on Friday.
Maybe you should call it BetterHelp.
Or Thursday. I thought Breakdown was very underrated. Very, very good movie. And then this weekend, we went right into and are halfway through Copland.
Okay, that's a nice genre.
I'm enjoying this area.
Would you agree with me after seeing it that J.T. Walsh is one of the great character actors of our time?
He's very, very good. I'd have to look and be reminded of what other things
he's been in.
I know
like
from.
Executive decision. He's been in like everything.
Is he always a heel?
Well, not always, but he's not the star, but he's a very integral part of whatever movie he's in. Take a look at his IMDb. You will be blown away in the movies that he's been in.
Well, I'm already looking right now. It's
a breakdown, Michael. I think it was a 97 vehicle. You know the movie?
No. Fine film with Kurt Russell. Kurt Russell vehicle. He's in Sling Blade, Executive Decision, Nixon, The Babysitter, Outbreak, Blue Chips.
He's in everything. Blue Chips. He was the one that was the big booster.
He's in The Sniper, Few Good Men, Backdraft.
Let's go to Norris Misery. In Michigan.
Tequila Sunrise, The Big Picture.
Who cares?
Hey, good afternoon, guys.
Hey, Norris.
How's it going? Michael, I wanted to touch on two points that you actually brought up, the two topics that I wanted to talk about. One was Soto. You know, in the beginning when we first acquired him, a lot of Yankee fans, like you said, you know, overrated, but not worth the pay at the end of the season. Why do trades for him? We gave up too much. I think, like you pointed to, Yankee fans and every baseball fan that wasn't watching Soto on a daily basis knows he's good. But it's like fans were like, how good is this guy? Listen, I'm tuning into any Padres game that was on last season, that was on national television, and you watch Soto. I mean, when you get to watch this guy for 600 plate appearances, every strike, every pitch that this guy takes, I mean, look no further than the hitter at bat. The pitches that he was taking, the inside pitch that made it to the 3-2 count, I mean, this man, his eye is generational. You can't really teach that. I don't think anybody will ever come close to the talent that he has in the batter's box. His discipline, it's just uncanny. It's crazy. I mean, when you get to see this for a full season, it's like, man, you're lucky to have this guy on your team. I mean, he's going to break records, I think. Like, he's already breaking records with his walks and his age. I mean, he's bringing a whole new dynamic to the Yankees that they haven't had in a while. I mean, it's such a scary at-bat for any pitcher. And then, you know, you have Judge behind him. So it's just
Norris, it made me wonder, what could you be thinking that, you know, I don't want him for just 1 year? I mean, you're getting one of the greatest players of all time at the age of 25. Not hyperbole, look it up. One of the greatest players of all time. Even if it's for 1 year, you do it. You go for the World Series this year. That's what they're doing. I mean, you've got Aaron Judge, 31. You've got Gerrit Cole, about to turn 34. You got Rizzo, who's 34. You've got Stanton, who's 34. Well, what are you waiting for? If your hands are on the windowsill, you might get your fingers hit. You go out and you get the best player you could possibly get. Give Brian Cashman and the Yankee organization credit.
When was the last time the Yankees had this level of just an on-base machine?
Well, Giambi was an on-base machine, but he wasn't near the player.
But that's a while ago, by the way.
When we get back, Peter is going to give the filmography of every single, like, secondary character in movie history. That's going to be fun, so I'm looking forward to it as well.
You know what? He's a bad guy. That's the truth. We're just having a little fun.
Did you realize where you were going? The rabbit hole that you were drilling into?
We named six movies.
But if I didn't take Norris's phone call, you'd still be gone.
No, I think I would have wrapped up shortly thereafter.
Well, Don. I think he would eventually got to end.
Is Don who you want to go to on this subject?
Yeah.
Do I need to remind you of the list? Don appreciates it going through a good list.
No, I do, but I asked you to check it out. I didn't ask you to read down the whole filmography. And now, you might have been done by the time we got to the break.
And also, I apologize, Don, because obviously Peter doesn't have a clock where he is, because he would have seen. Well, that's not the thing to do at 5:20.
Wait, but hold on. But then you did...
Did what?
5:20. But then we went for another 5. Okay.
I don't think he was talking about clock integrity.
You mean because it's the all-important 5:20?
Yes, that's what he's talking about.
Guess what? No rating. Sue me. Next.
Well, I talk for a living.
Michael, you can't pick arbitrarily. Don, 1 minute he's the one way. The next minute he's the next way.
I never would do something so tripey at 5 o'clock. I just wouldn't. I don't even know who you were talking about. I had no idea who you were talking about.
There are times I think you do a 3.5-hour tripey show. It's all in the eye of the beholder.
Oh, well, because I talk about sports?
Sometimes. Sometimes what you consider sport, I consider old men babbling to the moon.
You might be in the wrong business.
You might. Maybe you're old. You should get out of the business.
No, I think I'm just the right age.
Well, now we're in the clock
integrity
part. Yeah,
just the right age to move into the Hebrew home.
What a jerk.
But that's not even the read he's going to do.
Well, if he was, though, think about how good it would be. It's a risk I had to take.
I talk for a living, and I will for a lot longer than Peter. And whether I'm in the studio...
The Michael Kay Show on Yes is brought to you by FanDuel. Make every moment more.
Hey, so I found a betting system that's really working great for me.
So did I. What's yours?
I set up an hour a week time limit on FanDuel. I can also set up wager limits, so I only bet what I can afford, and betting saves fun.
Right.
So what's your system?
What's that?
Your system. What's your system? What is that?
Every bettor has a system. Make FanDuel's responsible gaming tools a key part of yours.
When you order from Domino's, you can get more than just pizza. You can get specialty chicken, savory pastas, oven-baked Parmesan bread bites, molten lava crunch cakes, and medium two-topping pizzas as well. We didn't stop at pizza, and you don't have to either.
The best ideas come from solving common problems. My problem, like a lot of other men, I couldn't find a shirt that looked good untucked. So this became my passion, to design a shirt that captures the perfect balance between length and fit. Easy to say, not that easy to do. But with some innovative design changes, we did it. Our problem, my solution. Untuckit.com.
New season, new reasons to say yes.
Wow!
Yes to the ultimate viewing experience.
Aaron Judge crushes one.
The Yes app. Download now.
Yankee streaming is brought to you by Toyota.
Wounded Warrior Project has been with me every step of my journey.
Aaron, how you doing, buddy?
With experiences that help me realize that I'm not alone.
And specialized programs that give me the tools to train my body and mind.
Now it's possible for me to get back out there.
To get out of my comfort zone and try new things.
To build and be part of a community that supports other warriors.
It's possible to get the help I need for me and my family.
I got my confidence back. I'm setting goals and I'm achieving them.
It's possible to feel understood. Whether it's day one or 20 years down the road, they've got your back.
And as each warrior's needs evolve, Wounded Warrior Project is adapting to meet them.
Because when we pull together,
it's possible to go further than you ever imagined.
Is it possible to be more capable and more practical? Be able to perform here and here. Make a statement while barely making a sound. And command the road, as well as what lies ahead. How we get there matters. Get exceptional offers at your local Audi dealer.
At Bet365, we don't do ordinary. Our incredible same-game parlay gets even better when you add Profit Boost. You can still combine all of your favorite selections to increase your potential winnings, but now we're giving you the option to boost your profit up to an extra 30%. Look out for a Profit Boost on select games and see why it's never ordinary at Bet365.
With Allegra, allergies won't hold me back. Allegra starts working two times faster than Claritin, and unlike Zyrtec, won't make me drowsy. Nothing beats Allegra. It's the fastest non-drowsy 24-hour allergy relief.
Chris here.
K Show. This look at the pitching matchup in Arizona tonight is brought to you by Montefiore, the official hospital of the New York Yankees. It'll be the season debut for Luis Gil. He last threw a pitch in the majors back in May of 2022 before having Tommy John surgery. In five spring training appearances, the 25-year-old Dominican was impressive, pitching to an ERA under three and a batting average against of 127. He will go toe-to-toe with 26-year-old righty Ryan Nelson, who will be making his first start of the season as well. Our coverage for tonight's tilt in Arizona begins with the pregame show at 9 o'clock, followed by first pitch a little after 9:30. It's the Yankees and the Diamondbacks, starting up a three-game set in the desert tonight at 9, right here on YES, and streaming, of course, on the YES app.
Two-minute report just came out, and it said that Dort jumps to contest Brunson's shot. And following contact by Hartenstein on Dort, Dort makes incidental contact with Brunson after the shot is released. So they say it was a correct no call. So no kick coming on that. I think that what the Knicks have to worry about, and they've had a tremendous season, and Jalen Brunson should finish in the top eight MVP voting, maybe even higher. They can't go far riding a six-foot guard. They've got to have help. I mean, you've got to have Anunoby back. You've got to get Randall back. They've been doing it up to this point because everybody is really extending themselves. But if it's hard to win with a smallish point guard. It's been done. It's been done. But it's very few and far between. And as great as Brunson is, I think you're putting too much on this guy's shoulders. Right. I just do.
It would be the exception, not the rule, if they're able to do it. Now, I don't even care much about the size. It's just that, Michael, they just kill themselves every single game. And, yeah, it's one thing to lose to the Spurs, but that's a game where you're hoping you take care of business, can rest some starters in the fourth quarter. Instead, you lose the game. Brunson was unbelievable. But, you know, you lose the game, and then you lose a heartbreaker to the Thunder. And now you find yourself back in the four seed again, trying to hold off the Magic for five. When we were actually having a conversation on Friday that there was a scenario where they could very easily finish as the two. But now you're three back of the Bucks, so I don't think that's going to happen in the final, what, eight? Now, they caught a break. Cleveland lost, and Cleveland's lost six of their last 10. So now instead of maybe finishing second, now you got to try to hold off the Magic for five.
I mean, listen, this is what it's going to be. It's going to be very tight. You lose a couple games. This is what it is. But I'm less concerned about them losing two tight games, even though last night was frustrating, obviously. I mean, a couple of made free throws, and we're not having this conversation. And also, you just can't let Gilchrist Alexander get that shot at that point in the game. But these things happen. The bigger concern is just the concern from Josh Hart that you're not going to see these guys again. That's the worry.
And Woj is reporting that the Knicks don't want to play Anunoby until all the inflammation is out. Now, I am loath to question anybody about injuries. But if you're going to wait to feel 100% in April, you're not going to play. You're not going to play. And I think the guy is hurt. He obviously had surgery to move the bone chip. And then he re-injured himself reaching on a defensive play. But if OG is waiting for himself to be 100% to get back, he might not get back. Well, he just might not get back.
And now if you couple that with when are we going to see Randall, now you just wonder exactly how far do you expect this team to go? And do you really want to get those guys back in the postseason? Wouldn't you like to get some games under your belt before you have to play the Magic or the Cavaliers in the first round of the playoffs?
Well, if you look at last year, and I believe that Julius was still feeling it because he is a guy that will play when he's not 100%.
Of course.
But he missed the last part of the last five, six games of the season with the ankle injury, came back, and he was not the same player. Now, it's hard to just get right back into the flow of things, so I'm worried a little bit. They're a tremendous team. They're a great story. They play hard. But if you're not going to have Anunoby and Randall back, do you really think you're knocking off Milwaukee? Do you really think you're knocking off Boston? I don't think you are.
We talked about this before, Michael. The problem is that as much as we despise load management, there's a reason why it's done. to be fresh for the postseason. And just to be able to get as high as they're going to need to get to feel good going into the playoffs and playing as shorthanded as they have, it's going to – what's Brunson going to be able to give you? If they have a compromised Brunson, they're done. Can we agree with that? You know, so – and there's going to probably be no chance here to give him any kind of rest. And the guy just doesn't know how to not give 110% every time he's out on the court. So as much as we loathe load management and we hate it, blah, 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 it – you understand why these teams do it, because they want to be fresh for the big run. And the Knicks are trying to do both. They're trying to give the fans and their ability to win every single game and not rest anybody and play a ton of minutes and then expect to make a run against teams that are going to be a lot fresher than they are when they get to the playoffs. Maybe not the first round, but certainly when they start dancing with Milwaukee and Boston. And then how's Philadelphia going to be? Where do we feel about Embiid in the postseason? Is he going to be there? Is he going to be fresh because he didn't play? Where are we going to stand with Philadelphia if you have to face them?
It's intriguing because if you think about how close they were to moving into the two spot, and now, as you mentioned, they're trying not to drop to the fifth spot. And these are not easy eight games they have remaining. Everybody's playing for something. Everybody's playing for something. So I'm a little bit nervous.
I'm not going to play the game of, like, every time we hear about something going wrong, I fall into the media guy of, oh, well, this is the thing that's going to sink this team. They have bounced back and been incredibly, incredibly resilient throughout this season. Part of me still, minus Randall and Anunoby, feels that they would be a very tough out for anyone and could still go a couple of rounds. So. What can they do about that? Like, you can only do so much.
Well, listen, I've been following the Rangers here, and I can tell you from a Rangers standpoint, they have missed out on long runs and championships because of how many games they had to play early in the playoffs. It does amount to a lot. Like, if the Rangers can get a matchup in the first round where they can sweep or win in five games, that's going to do a world of good for them later on in the playoffs. If you've got to go seven hard games with Orlando or Cleveland, it's going to affect you, Peter, especially if the Bucks and the Celtics make short work of their teams. I mean, when you go into a matchup late in the playoffs where you've maybe played four or five more games than the other team, and that team was able to rest some of their stars down the stretch because they didn't care exactly where they finished. I applaud what the Knicks are doing. But for a team that is probably not as good as the top teams in the conference, you don't think is it going to be a distinct disadvantage how much they had to work to get there compared to the other teams?
Oh, no, it's more than that. I'd probably go as far as saying I'd give them no chance at winning the whole thing. But that doesn't put me in a – I don't think they're winning the whole thing this year anyway. So to me, it's like I'm not going to get too far down now if they're not going to get those guys back. Is it disappointing? Sure. And it would be a huge bonus if they could at least get one of them back. But I frankly, guys, with all due respect, I don't see them winning the title this year. So if they don't get them back, and I think they could still play two series in this playoff. So why start getting all, I don't know, I'm not sure what they're going to do. It seems like they always step up just when everyone's given up.
I don't think you're talking about championship. We're just talking about getting to the conference final because I think, you know, they already made it to the second round last year and would be looked upon as a disappointment if you're bounced in the second round again. But do we have to adjust our expectations if they might go into the playoffs without Randall and OG? Like, can they realistically get to the third round without those two guys healthy?
Third round would be tough.
Now, Fred Katz in The Athletic said, since trading away Barrett and Quickley, New York is averaging 123.1 points per 100 possessions, which is an elite figure, with Brunson on the court. But they go down to 103.4 when he's off. And you saw that in the game against OKC. You can't rest this guy. The way the team is built right now, he's got to play 48 minutes a game. And he's going to be able to do that in a playoff series where every single possession is intense. Some concerns. I don't think we should ever lose sight of what a great season it's been, but these injuries just kill you. Kill you.
No, they're going to catch up to you. They are. And not so much having to play by what you miss from those guys, but how much extra the other guys have to work to compensate. Brunson clearly can do it, Michael, but can he do it over a long, long period of time?
Let's go to the phones. Let's go to John and Trumbull. John.
Hey, guys. Hey, Michael. Hey, Peter. Hey, Don. Yeah, so I've been a long-time listener, and just to kind of talk about a few things you guys have been talking about, I'm a huge Knicks fan myself. Love Brunson. He's a phenomenal player. But your point, Michael, about a six-foot guard, it reminds me kind of Allen Iverson for the Sixers or even Georgetown. He never won. He was incredible. He's one of the quickest guys I've ever seen, great jump shot, but didn't have the pieces around him. And he got worn down in the playoffs. If you remember that year they made the championship, by that series, he was worn down because he had to do so much for that Sixer team. But it's tough.
And also, John, a lot of people bring up Steph. Steph had a lot of help. That Brunson doesn't.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Great point. But I really called to talk about UConn basketball. I've been a long-time high school basketball coach, college basketball fan, and this is one of the most complete basketball teams I've seen in all my years of watching college hoops. I mean, they have the inside game with Donovan Clingan. The guy coming off the bench is phenomenal. They have Tristan Newton, one of the best point guards in the country. Castle, his defense might be top five in the nation. He shut down Illinois' best player that was averaging like 30 a game in the tournament. The guy was completely shut down. They went on a 30-0 run in the second half. I haven't seen that in college basketball. So I know it's never a foregone conclusion. I know Villanova beat Georgetown in 85. Everyone knows that. But this UConn team, would you say in the last 10 years, this might be the most complete college basketball team you guys have seen?
It's amazing because it has so many pieces. And Clingan gives them a different feel than you don't usually get in college sports. Well, you're going to have it with Edie as well, with Purdue. The one thing that I noticed, guys, I don't know how much of the UConn games that you watch, but I watched a lot of it. They every 50-50 ball, they play with an animalistic intensity on every single possession. They get every 50-50 ball. They out-hustle the opposition constantly. He has them playing like their hair is on fire. It's an unbelievable coaching job by Hurley and unbelievable players. I don't see them losing. I don't.
No. I mean, they've got the record for most consecutive double-digit wins in the tournament. They're incredible. And, yeah, you're right, that when you see hustle like that, that comes from the coach.
Did you hear that Larry David yelled at him? Because David was at the game in Boston because he's doing tonight an evening with Larry David.
Okay.
When he was bored?
And he went to the game. And so he was bored, but he's heckling Hurley. Put your subs in. Enough. Stop coaching. He never finds something he doesn't have an opinion on.
Well, and they kept showing him on the big screen looking bored and kind of miserable.
Right.
I'll tell you what, Larry is sure not holding back getting his moment down the stretch here.
Cursed out Chris Wallace.
Cursed out Chris Wallace. He's doing multiple live shows. He's been on CNN. He is just, it feels like he's been nonstop.
Remember when he used to come on our show? Now he's on Rich Eisen all the time.
No, it hurts, by the way.
It does. It bothers me. It does.
Well, Rich Eisen's not going to talk Rangers because he had a Ranger drop in the show yesterday.
I didn't watch it yet.
I didn't watch it yet, but everybody told me about it, and I did see the scene. He's talking about Panarin.
All right, we're going to find out who the point guard is. I can tell you it's not me today.
Why do you say that?
Because I don't feel that I made any cogent points.
I think you're right.
So we'll see. Coming back in just a moment, right here on Yes and 98.7 ESPN.
Growing up, I always wanted to do so many things.
I wanted to be a vet.
I wanted to be an actor.
When I was really little, I don't know why, but I wanted to be a pastor. When I was like a small child,
I wanted to be a celebrity, like by any means necessary.
This is Spike Drop Vegas Heist.
These players are playing for a lot of money today.
I'm only here for a two-peat. I don't really care about any other place.
My dad is a gamer.
My dad.
My brother.
My mom.
My grandmother.
My dad's a big gamer, still is.
People will either like me or they will hate me. And I think that's fine. I'm okay with that.
I can't even comprehend what is going on, but I like it.
Today,
consider myself the luckiest man on the face of the earth, dude.
Playing in Yankee Stadium is the best thing that could ever happen to a ball player.
It's a huge honor to put this uniform on.
World champions, team of the decade.
There it goes!
The Yankees are back on top.
This is the Yankees being the Yankees.
New season, new reasons to say yes.
This is star power.
Wow.
What a home run for Soto. Aaron Judge crushes one.
Get all the Yankees action. The Yes app.
Listen up, Nets World. Get into the action and lock in a 2024-25 Nets level membership. Members have it all, from exclusive events and behind-the-scenes access to discounts across merch and tickets. Not to mention the ticket flexibility in the first place with round-the-clock management and seamless transfer to your squad. This is Brooklyn, and it's yours. Become a member today.
T2T.org.
Fantastic ride. The turbocharged, tech-inspired Kia Forte.
Best two out of three.
Lease the new 2024 Forte LXS for $189 a month.
Been there, done that, messed around. I'm having fun. Don't put me down. I'll never let you.
With Allegra, allergies won't hold me back.
I won't let you.
Allegra starts working two times faster than Claritin. And unlike Zyrtec, won't make me drowsy. Nothing beats Allegra. It's the fastest non-drowsy 24-hour allergy relief.
I have sickle cell. I've had lots and lots of blood transfusions over my lifetime. I'm most grateful that people are willing to go out there and take their time, their blood, and give me new life.
It's go time in Brooklyn, and we got grit.
Mikal Bridges has got a highlight.
We got game.
On the clutch attack.
We got goals.
Schroeder, does he have the hot hand?
Yes, sir. We got Pacers versus Nets. Wednesday at 7:30 on Yes and the Yes app.
Chris Sheeran back here for the Michael K. Show. These highlights are brought to you by Montefiore, the official hospital of the New York Yankees. Juan Soto does it again thanks to Gleyber Torres working a walk with two outs in the ninth to get Soto to the dish. Torres steals second. Soto facing his former teammate Josh Hader. He lines one into left to chase Torres home. Yankees up 4-3. They would head to the bottom half of the ninth where Clay Holmes allowed two singles to start the inning. And then Greg Nettles, John Birdie, saves the game with his diving stop at the hot corner.
for the first out. Holmes faced near doom again when Yordan Alvarez flirted with the line and left. Falls just foul, and that would have potentially ended things. Alvarez flied out to deep center later. Then Kyle Tucker laces this pitch into left, but Alex Verdugo got a good jump on it. Slides to make the game-ending catch. The Yankees get a four-game sweep in Houston to start the season. And a big reason for all the success was Juan Soto. The guy is an absolute freak and is as advertised. He had 20 plate appearances in Houston and reached base 12 times. He had two extra base hits, including his first home run as a Yankee. He drove in four and had the game-winning ribby in the last two games. His game-winning at-bat yesterday should be shown to young hitters everywhere. It was absolute textbook, and somewhere in the heavens, Tony Gwynn had to be smiling down.
Tells you is what Anthony thinks. That's the unfortunate part, Don. Is that it means Anthony? It's the point guard, right?
He's siding with Jeff. He thinks
I rigged.
He thinks there's shenanigans.
But think about it. He thinks that the drop madness that he runs, I rigged.
Oh my God!
Think about how telling that is. That's unbelievable. And you know what? It's the worst kind of gall that anyone can have.
So it's worse than unmitigated.
No, that's what I meant. Oh. Unmitigated. It can't get worse than unmitigated. What are you insane?
I've been told. This is the Yankees Diamondbacks pitching matchup tonight, brought to you by Serta Pro Painters. Luis Gil will make his first start for the Yankees. Look great in spring training. Ryan Nelson, who is 8-8 with a 5.31, he'll go against the Diamondbacks. Yankees are 4-0. The Diamondbacks are 3-1. Battle of first place teams. And that's the Yankees starting pitching matchup. Brought to you by Serta Pro Painters. When choosing a painting professional for your home or business, the choice is simple. Choose happy. Choose Serta Pro Painters. Let's go back to the phone calls. Tim, South Carolina. Tim.
Hey guys, I just wanted to call in and just rip on these atrocious Yankee calls we've been getting. Don, I know you threatened to leave on Thursday or Friday, whatever, last week.
Right.
Don't do it, man. Seriously. Because there's these old curmudgeon, old men shaking their hands at the clouds, just terrible, awful stuff. And I don't know why they're even Yankee fans, to be completely honest, because in, like, this morning on DNR, I heard all these people complaining about Soto hitting in the lineup, Judge not hitting, all this and that. Just shut up. Just watch the game. Enjoy it, for the love of God. Like, why are you baseball fans if you're going to... Ridiculous. And Don, seriously, don't leave.
No, I'm not going to leave. But it is frustrating, especially from my perspective as a Met fan, that I'd kill to have my team be as good as the Yankees have been over the last 10 years or so. But I'm trying to move on to Michael, that this is the very vocal minority of Yankee fans. I would think the majority of Yankee fans love this team, love what they're about, and do not nitpick to this point. At some point, you'll have something to complain about. But you know what? Right now, can you enjoy 4-0, embarrassing your hated rival, two of the games on national television? Well, Apple national adjacent, but you know what I mean.
Let's go to Richard in Manhattan. Richard.
Michael, there have been 55 baseball games so far this year, 55 different starting pitches. Only one out of 55 has gone over 100 pitches. Who is he?
Marcus Stroman.
That's right. Correct. Torres, Judge, Stanton, and Verdugo, you know what they're hitting combined?
What?
160, and they've won four straight. What shocks you more? Houston losing four straight against Texas in the AL Championship Series, or they opening up this season four straight losses against the Yankees at home?
In the ALCS.
You made a great comment about Judge. Game one, top of the fourth, 3-0 count, pitches at his knees. He's standing at home plate. He thinks it's a strike. Pete Rose would have been at first already by the time he put his head up. That was unbelievable. And then Verdugo, the batter ass, or two batters after, 3-1 count, bases loaded. The guy, Valdez, is all over the place. He pulls the ball, hits into a double play. That was unbelievable. How they came back after that to win was unbelievable. Last one, UConn, if they lose in the Final Four or in the championship, will it be the biggest upset in Final Four or championship series in the NCAA tournament. Bigger than Villanova beating Georgetown.
No.
Bigger than
UNLV.
Bigger than Texas Western beating Kentucky. Beating David Thompson and NC State beating UCLA with Walton. And Valvano's 83 NC State beating Houston. This will be bigger than any of them if they lose?
I don't think it's big. I mean, the UNLV one stands out to me as I mean, everyone thought they were going to destroy Duke. Destroy them. So, I mean, it would be a huge upset. But let's look at the spread, too. I mean, they should run away with these two games, but strange things have happened.
Yeah, it's really the two big ones that I can't get over. Like you said, Duke UNLV, before Duke was Duke.
Right, and Villanova Georgetown.
And the Villanova Georgetown is the first one that jumps out. I mean, Georgetown was every bit the Georgetown versus the field. You look at the players, you know, Patrick Ewing, how long those guys stayed together. Yeah, that's a... Yeah, listen, it would be unbelievable, but it's all adjusting to the one-and-dones and all that change everything.
So you saw the last play by Verdugo yesterday in left field?
Yeah, nice play.
It was a nice play, right? Nice play.
Well, I've seen it before, but it's a nice play.
Oh, well, here's the amazing thing. That play is listed as one of the highest probability base hits over the last couple of years.
Really? Like,
that had an 87% probability of being base hit, and I don't even think it was an extraordinary catch. No. It was a nice catch.
It was a sliding catch.
Yeah, I couldn't believe it.
I mean, it was a nice catch, but, you know, it's not Willie Mays in the 54 World Series.
No, it's not.
So what was the probability on that one? They just showed it on, come on, man. People, again, they're destroying
trying
themselves.
Trying too hard? They're trying too hard.
They might be.
It's all made up, too. Like, who's checking their math?
It's a good point. You just threw the whole thing into dispute.
96.5% chance that Peter nails ENN.
I'll take the under.
That's not how that bet works, but keep going.
So very quickly, Ian Begley writes, the Knicks are listing Mitchell Robinson as questionable.
He just came back.
For Miami tomorrow due to left ankle sprain he suffered in the loss to San Antonio on Friday. And they have changed the wording on OG Anunoby being out. Now it's elbow management.
Management.
Well, let's see. The current absence has changed from right elbow injury management to right elbow tendinopathy. You don't like tendinopathy?
No.
No.
But we like ENN. Coming up.
Oh, sure.
In just a second, right here on Yes and 98.7 ESPN.
The Michael K. Show on Yes is brought to you in part by Bigelow Tea, who encourages you to grab a mug and tea proudly.
It's amazing to think that my grandmother started Bigelow Tea right here in New York. And today, we're still a family company. And you have to remember, tea, that's all we do. So every cup counts. That means never compromising. My family won't let that happen. And our extended family, they give their all every single day. And our community, well, they expect that.
I want a cup of Bigelow Tea to be a moment just for you. That's what I hope for.
The best ideas come from solving common problems. My problem, like a lot of other men, I couldn't find a shirt that looked good untucked. So this became my passion, to design a shirt that captures the perfect balance between length and fit. Easy to say, not that easy to do. But with some innovative design changes, we did it. Our problem, my solution. Untuckit.com.
Welcome to Win Reality. Experience unlimited at-bats from home. See game speed pitches from more than 600 pitchers. Get ready for all game situations. Face your friends in live competitions. Win Reality. Baseball Uncaged.
When you order from Domino's, you can get more than just pizza for $6.99. You can get specialty chicken, savory pastas, oven-baked Parmesan bread bites, molten lava crunch cakes, and medium two-topping pizzas as well. We didn't stop at pizza, and you don't have to either.
We all want to feel safe when traveling. That's why if you see something that feels suspicious, such as an abandoned bag or erratic behavior from a passenger, just call 911. You can call anonymously, and it's okay if it turns out to be nothing. Work together with the Port Authority of New York and New Jersey to keep our transportation facilities safe. Visit PANYNJ.gov to learn more.
At Bet365, we don't do ordinary. That's why we encourage all of our players to take a break now and then. Just log in and set your timeout length. You can take a break from days to weeks at a time. Or you can customize it, so you can make every moment matter. When you play, play safe with Bet365.
For years, one company has battled to deliver business products the next day with no freight charges. Now, WB Mason, with their famous fleet of trucks and drivers, faces their biggest challenge, rescuing shipping and packaging buyers from expensive freight charges. That's right. Now, boxes, stretch film, and packaging tape are delivered the very next day at amazingly low prices. So, who do you call for fast delivery and no expensive freight charges? Who but WB Mason?
Watch the Yankees Hyundai Sunday Game of the Week, brought to you by your local Hyundai dealers. There's never been a better time to test drive that Hyundai you've always wanted. It's your journey. Own every mile in a brand new Hyundai. Visit buyhyundai.com today.
New season, new reasons to say yes.
This is star power.
Wow.
For Soto, Aaron Judge crushes one.
Get all the Yankees action. The Yes app. Download now.
The Community Food Bank of New Jersey is the state's largest anti-hunger organization. We provide nutrition. We provide support. We provide opportunity. We can't do it without you. Go to cfbnj.org to join us today.
What if you went to your secret hiding place and found this? All drug use comes with risk. Before those risks become real, know that you can quit. For help with drug use, call 1-800-662-HELP for free and confidential information and treatment referral. Or go to samhsa.gov/knowtherisks.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome, if you will, to ENN.
On TV.
Ray Rowe.
Sure. Guys, big special ENN brought to you by our friends at Security Dodge. Go see Michelle Scalise.
Come get some.
Yeah.
I'd like to start off tonight's big ENN by saying good evening to Michael.
Please vote for my wife.
Yeah, that's just something that didn't happen, which is what you just heard. But, Michael, it's not surprising, is it? I mean, Don, it's not surprising.
No.
Thank you. Let's say good evening to Don, Michael, and Jeff.
You know, you don't have DJ Martinez yet and all that, but they got punked
JD.
Again.
JD. JD. Saying DJ.
I don't know why I do that.
Come on, man.
All right, you know what? I'm going to tap out. Jeff, have a good day.
Take it easy, Don.
Jeff was ready for me to tap out. He was good.
I got to tell you got to give credit for someone being that ready to just say take it easy.
I didn't even hear him say that in real time.
That's how good he is. He's one of the best in the business. That's a fact, what I just said. Let's say good evening to Don.
Hoskins resides in their head. I'm of the belief that if you're Jeff O'Neill really? And you're going to get mad, punch him. Really?
I'm sorry, Don.
I'm not mad at you.
And good evening to Don.
You didn't make the draw. The comedian doesn't have a relationship with the fat guy in the first row.
And good evening to Don. I don't know why you're challenging this way.
Because I could tell when people...
Yeah, I could hear that. That was...
I told you. Michael, do you hear that swing?
No.
Why you're challenging this way.
I could tell when people...
But he's trying to make it comparable to the ice, Michael.
No, let me hear the ice. It's out of drop madness, sadly. But the ice was unbelievable. In retrospect, I didn't... Go ahead.
Do it.
Oh, he's going to find it.
Tickets are on sale now at Ticketmaster.com. You know, that's the last thing they heard on the Titanic.
This is a tough one for me. Good evening to myself. He's in Sniper. Few Good Men. Backdraft. Misery.
Go to Norris in Michigan.
Tequila Sunrise. The Big Picture.
Good job, Michael. Can I take the opportunity? Shining Windsor's Kevin wants us to give a shout out to his dad, Joe, who turned 74 today. A spry 74, Shining Wizards Kevin describes
it. Is that Shining Wizards Joe?
I guess, yeah. No. I guess that would be his dad, yeah.
Happy birthday, Joe.
Is he also, he's also a Shining Wizard?
Well, unless Shining Wizards Kevin is an original.
But you don't know if he goes by, if it's a family name, the Shining Wizards.
I don't think he goes by that. No. He's a 74-year-old man.
Here's another tough one for me. Good evening to myself. Oh, no. You just can't let Gilchrist Alexander get that shot at that point in the game. That's not what you want. No. And let's say good evening to Jeff Passan.
Oh, my God.
That's kind of the highlight. It was a great rant. He really brought it. But that, to me, was what it's all about. I don't know if you guys are aware, but there's a really big basketball game tonight. Yeah. No, I know. It's Iowa and it's LSU, and it's in the tournament. Michael, you were on your sabbatical when Don and I spoke about how the women's tournament started out with the top seeds getting their early games at home. What do you think about that? I sort of like it.
I don't love it. I mean, because UConn essentially has played at home, but not at home. You know, they were in Brooklyn, they were in Boston, so they never really had to get on a plane.
But
the part of taking those early round games and by playing them on someone's home court, you just add such a level of excitement to the building instead of those like random games at Capital One Arena in D.C. that look empty.
Well, I hear what you're saying, but I think it's too much of a negative for the other team.
I hear you. That's fair. Let's hear from Angel Reese. What's her game plan for Caitlin Clark today?
Last year, the scouting report was just to contain her as best as we can and not let the surrounding players score as much as they could. So we're going to do the same thing again this year. I mean, she's scoring 30 when they win. She's scoring 30 when they lose. So it's a win-win-lose situation with it. So we're just going to have to not allow those other players to score.
And Caitlin Clark, how about the rematch with LSU?
I think we're excited. I think, you know, anytime you have a chance to go up against somebody you lost to, it brings a little more energy. But at this point in the tournament, every single team is good, whether you're playing West Virginia, whether you're playing Colorado, whether you're playing LSU. You prep the exact same way. You come in with the same exact mindset. And I think overall it's just going to be a really great game for women's basketball. And they're really solid 1-5.
Over under 12 million viewers.
That's a lot.
I'll go under. And I have a lot of respect for what's going to happen tonight.
That's a lie. I just looked it up. It's like, I think The Bachelor did like 5 million. That's a lot, Michael. I don't want to like, then you'd like set up for disappointment. I think it's going to be very, very well viewed. It doesn't really have anything going up against. I mean, but there's
listen, I'm not trying to be that guy, but it is the Raw before WrestleMania with The Rock advertised.
I didn't know the audience has crossed over.
They do. Well, they really do. I mean, I am literally the perfect example of the two things that would interest me tonight are The Rock being on Raw the week before WrestleMania and then this basketball game. Those are the two things I would think about.
And then Yankees Diamondbacks.
Well, of course, but that's after, Michael.
Yeah, but that would be after.
It's on the same time as USC and UConn.
But that's not what I don't think you're saying it's going to get 12 million for the second game.
Yeah, No.
I think it's going to be a little over 10 million.
No, but I think it's going to be terrific. And
the drop off's going to be monstrous when the Iowa LSU game ends. I'm sorry, guaranteed.
Now, you need a good game, you need a classic. And if you get that, then I think a lot of people could parachute in to a late game, but if it's a blowout, I think that could really affect it. It's on the hearts and minds of a lot of sports fans today. There might be in a rotation. You know, if you're in New York, you've got, you know, Yankees, Mets. If it looks like the weather's going to be okay, Rangers, Penguins. There's a lot of things, but I think it's on your radar, and how much you're on it will depend on the quality of the game.
I agree with 100%. If you tune in, Don, like you throw it on at the start of the second half, and it's already a 15-point game, you might be out. You know, it sort of requires if you're a casual, you need it to be a decent game to stick around.
You think Ruko is nervous right now?
No.
No way.
Really? This might be the biggest audience he ever announces to.
It's actually, no, you know what? It definitely is.
Yeah, because
it has to be.
Because he's done some ABC games for the NBA, but that's going to probably get you what? Maybe
four,
something in that vicinity. It should crush that.
But he had the women's final last year. That got a great number.
What was the number last year? We're talking about what it could be. Now, obviously, Caitlin Clark's way bigger now than she was last year. But what was the – can we get that, Anthony? What was the number last year?
I think it was close to 10.
Well, then maybe 12 is on the table because I would think there's more buzz than now than it was last year. But that was the final last year.
Yep. And it was on ABC.
That was $9.9 million on ABC for the final.
But this is way more – this has become a bigger deal because of that game. That game has made this game a much bigger deal.
So is he nervous or not?
No.
You know what? I'm not rule. I don't know if I'd use the word nervous.
Anxious?
Anxious.
But I'd say there's probably a little extra thought going into it.
You owe me a Fresca. You know, because the only thing, knowing Ryan, he is very confident in his skills. The only thing he sometimes could worry about is, you know, how is he feeling? Is the voice going to hold up? Things like that. But he's money.
Turned us down today, by the way.
Because that's why I went there, because he was doing a lot. So that tells me that maybe he was a little conscious of, you know, having the strength in his voice for the game. So those are the things he worries about. His play-by-play and knowing the players and stuff, he's got that cold. He doesn't worry about that. Nerves for me come from lack of preparedness. He's not unprepared.
Peter must be nervous every show.
Oh, I really get geared up. It's tough.
That's a bigger shot than you're giving it credit for, Peter.
I didn't. What it's a bigger? What was the line that you said right before it? You said it's bigger. How? Why? Why does one get nervous?
Well, it's not preparedness.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, it's true. That does make every day tough here, especially ENN. But let's get to a bigger story for our local audience.
That's a nice response.
Let's get to a bigger story for our local audience, and that's the New York Knickerbockers. Because not only did the Knicks lose a couple close games over the weekend, including that heartbreaker last night at the Garden to OKC, but Josh Hart had some interesting things to say after the game about the future of this team and the availability of two of its top players.
I'm looking at it like this is a team that we're going to have. You know, I think that's how, you know, we have to approach it. You know, that those guys, you know, aren't coming back. And then obviously we'll be pleasantly surprised if they come back. You know, I'm not in those medical conversations or anything like that. So I don't know, you know. But, you know, we got to approach it every game and the end of the season. You know, those guys aren't coming back. And if they do, be pleasantly surprised.
So not preparing for Anunoby and Randall to be available.
Pleasantly surprised.
That's not what you want.
I think they'd really be surprised if Randall comes back.
At all? Or regular season?
At all.
Hmm. That's not nothing.
No, it's not great. And it does make you think that if that was the case, why didn't they go for surgery earlier on?
That's what the question's going to be.
But I understand why they didn't. You're going to try to get him back on the court, and maybe it's not possible. Then you have the surgery.
But at this point, you've waited too long anyway, so now you might as well wait and see.
Yep.
But the Anunoby part is interesting because if in fact it's true that he could be playing, but he just doesn't have he's not a pain tolerance guy.
Well, that was the one knock against him in Toronto. He didn't play all the time.
Yeah, and in this version of the NBA, you know, if you're not a guy who feels it, you're not feeling it. No one's going to say anything about it.
See, I think it's unfair to start throwing around he could play, but he doesn't want to. Like, the team is saying that it's management. So I think a lot of these decisions are based upon not just the player, I don't want to go, that they just collectively get together and say, I think we've got bigger fish to fry here. Let's get ready. Do you think it's a question of him not wanting to fight through the pain or not wanting to play because he's not 100%, or do you think this is all collaborative?
It's a good question. He's probably looking at it, you know what? You cleared me, and then I got hurt again. So I'm not coming back until I'm 100%. Maybe they agree. Now, he's got another thing on his plate. He's going to be a free agent. Big Finish makes him a lot of money.
Well, and what a weird situation for the Knicks. It's a bizarro situation. When he's available, he is as big a game changer as this team has had, short of Jalen Brunson. I mean, their winning percentage with him is like 90. It's crazy. But then he's not available. So it's really, you know what I'm saying? That's a really hard thing. Don, you like have to get him back to see more. You know, like, how do you sign someone if there's a chance they're not going to be available for you? But when they're available, they're fantastic.
Well, that's what you got to get behind, is it's just an injury that he, like Michael said, I don't want to go out there less than 100%, get hurt again. Or is it, listen, I only play when I'm 100%. Because I think there are two different things there, and one can affect your money. Like, I don't want to sign a guy for big money, and if he doesn't feel like playing, he's not going to play. But it's another thing to say, listen, he wants to make sure these games are big, that he's there for the team. So what's the answer? I'm sure these general managers know the real answer.
And you would think that he knows he makes more money if the Knicks go far and he's playing. So maybe he's really hurt.
Well, or does he look at it as, and again, I'm not accusing him of this, I'm just playing devil's advocate. Hey, look at how they played without me. Look at what their record was when I played, and look what their record was without me. So if he doesn't play in the postseason, they get bounced in the first round, does that work to his favor? Of look how important I was to this team.
Well, he knows he's important, but the Knicks also have to weigh how often is he going to play for us if we sign him to a long-term deal. Because if he's not able to get on the court when he's in the last year of his contract, what if he's in the middle of a four-year contract?
It's a lot to think about. It is a lot to think about. Let's go to something everybody's happy about, and that was the start of your New York Yankee baseball season. And let's hear from a man who's batting over 500. Big, big hits in clutch spots. Big on defense all weekend for your 4-0 Yankees. Here's Juan Soto. He likes the high-pressure situations.
Always going to be up in that situation. That's what we play for. I mean, we all know it's going to be times that we do fail, and sometimes you're going to have success. But I always want to be up there. I don't mind to be up there and get all the boos or all the claps. I'm always ready for it.
Here's Verdugo, Soto's new teammate.
Dog. You know what I mean? Like, let's just put it like that. He's a dog, bro. Like, I can't say nothing else. This is, we're dogs out here.
He got that dog in him.
Yeah, big dog. Dog, dog, dog. It's a dog-eat world dog. You know what I mean, guys?
Dog-eat
Snoop
world?
Snoop Dogg Double G.
Isn't it dog-eat a dog-eat dog world? Dog world? Not a dog-eat dog?
When you're right, you're right. It's a dog-eat dog world. Or, in the case of the Snoop Dogg masterpiece album, Doggy Style, the song is called Doggy Dog World, not Dog Eat Dog World.
Mm.
Speaking of which, oh boy, did I enjoy the Beyonce album. I really recommend it.
The country one?
Yes, I would say it's country adjacent.
Cowboy Carter.
So it's, that's right, Cowboy Carter.
Yeah, but
it's got a country theme throughout it, but there are definitely there's definitely a handful or more songs that are not very country.
But the Jolene, that's country. You can't not have that be country.
No, the Jolene one is definitively a country song. That's right.
Well, good for her.
It's a cover. And it's wonderfully done. She changed the words, too. She has Dolly on the album doing an interlude to a little intro to that song and then background vocals on another song. There's a Willie Nelson interlude as well. It's a very enjoyable listen.
That doesn't get enough play.
Go ahead.
That he's like 91 years old and he's collaborating on albums. He's still touring.
Oh, he's the man.
I think he's the pot.
It has to be. Because he smokes weed every day.
Wow. Full circle. You see that?
Smoke weed every day.
They don't give these jobs to chimps.
Mm.
Wow. That's unfortunate.
I'm not going to ask you, Michael, this to reveal, but I'm just kind of curious. When he said that, he envisioned someone in his mind.
Yeah.
When he said smoke weed every day.
No.
When he said what?
When you said they don't give this job to chimps. And Michael went,
He was referring to anything to me?
If he wants to give it, great, but I don't.
You think it was me, though?
I think he envisioned someone in his head when he went,
Wow. The question was, unbelievable. Was it me? Was it you who it was about?
It doesn't have to be somebody on the show. I see the way the business is going.
Yeah. There's a lot of people. TV, radio, podcasts. I'm sure he envisions some.
Chimps.
Actual chimps.
And in some cases, I would say you're actually besmirching the chimp.
Good point.
Now, I do I do have some sad news today that came down the line that we have not spoken about. Former NFL cornerback Vontae Davis was found dead on Monday at 35 years old. There was a medical call. Officers responded to a house assistant who had found the homeowner deceased, and they confirmed that it was Vontae Davis. In 2018, after leaving the Colts for the Bills, he abruptly retired at halftime of a game against the Chargers. But he was a really, really nice player, and that is just a really, really sad story. This it does happen quite a bit in the NFL, doesn't it, guys?
I mean, the first thing I read was natural causes. At 35, people die of natural causes?
Now, is natural causes just, we don't know, the family doesn't want it revealed, we got to put something down, so we just say natural causes?
I don't know.
Because it's not natural for a 35-year-old to just die.
Correct.
It's got to be a reason for it, but I'm just wondering if, like, clerically, it gets thrown down there because the family doesn't want an autopsy. They don't want it investigated. They've already said there's no foul play, so there's no reason if the family doesn't want to know for it to be revealed. So that has to be the reason, right? 35-year-olds just don't up and die without a reason.
That's the thing. Yeah, Don, what does natural causes mean? It's speaking of great defensive players gone way too soon, today would have been Sean Taylor's 41st birthday.
That's not old.
But you know what's so weird to me, Don? It makes me feel like I picture him as such a kid. I can't believe. I wonder. Right. I just like the whole back end of his career never happened. Like it's just so weird to picture him now as a 41-year-old because he was so young during his playing career.
Like thinking of Elvis if he lived. Would he look like Willie Nelson now?
Well, but Elvis, how old was Elvis when he died?
42. Early 40s?
42.
40. Mm. It's hard to picture there was any version of Elvis that was living to 91. It's just.
Well, you wouldn't have said this. You could say the same thing about Willie Nelson, right?
Fair. What a great point. I guess you're right. I guess you're right. But, I mean, it's when you look at Elvis at the end. But maybe if he didn't go that path, obviously he'd be here at 91.
I mean, it's scary, but listen, If Elvis was alive today at 42, would we be talking about him being morbidly obese? Now, he was obviously fatter than he was when he was big in the 50s and 60s, but come on, relatively speaking, I don't think people would bat an eye
by
today.
The way, people I got to get a drop madness, yes. But people overstate the morbidly obese part. Yeah. It was the drugs and stuff that were really killing Elvis there at the end. Guys, it's time for drop madness. Let's get into it. It's a blowout. Sorry, Don. The sixth seed in the flub region advances.
Hit the post by the backhand. That one worked.
That's good. That Don, Michael, that could be on a run.
I hate that it is.
Yeah, I know. It's tough for you. In the funny region, the 11 seed moves on.
I've got a team that stinks.
See, there you go. That's the Don he likes to be known for. We move over to the troubling region. Somehow, yet again, another Don. The 3 seed advances.
Your face against the freaking television screen, and you can't remember who didn't bunt.
Why do we even do this?
I know. There's no point, Michael. That's why you got to root for shot went one. Otherwise, it's... then we go to the nether region. Sorry, Danny. The 3 seed advances. That is it. Congratulations, Paul. Right. Could be on a. I'll tell you what. Paul and Griffin could be on a collision course.
Now, Michael caught it.
Yeah.
But originally, when you talked about him pronouncing, articulating, enunciating every single one of the letters, Michael said 5 and then corrected it to 6.
Yeah.
So we all had a really rough day.
That's right. And that'll do it for ENM, brought to you by Security Dodge. Shop 24/7 at securitydodge.com during their Dodge Power Shot Jeep celebration and Ram Truck Month.
Big Ranger game, Don's all over it. Big Yankee game, I'm all over it.
Oh, are you kidding me? And I'm going to Monday Night Raw.
You are going.
Yeah, Barclays Center. Rock, you kidding me?
Should be good. We'll have it all covered tomorrow on the big women's basketball doubleheader starting on ESPN at 7. Oh, please stay tuned. Watch it all. In the words of Billy Joel, life is a series of hellos and goodbyes. I'm afraid it's time for goodbye again. See ya. That's a wrap on the show for today. Don't forget, coming up at 9 o'clock, our coverage.
coverage of the Yankees and Diamondbacks begins with the pregame show. For all of us here on the Michael Kay Show, this is Chris Sheeran saying have a great night. We'll see you again tomorrow at 3 o'clock. The Michael Kay Show on Yes is presented by Untuck It. Shirts designed to be worn untucked